I am the harbinger of the end times!
And now, episode 9 of the D6 Generation, recording in the spacious studios high atop the ivory tower in the Wakeland compound, which looks nothing like a basement full of girls' toys.
And now, your hosts, Craig Gallant, Russ Wakeland, and Rafe, Hollywood, Granger. And today, featuring special guest, Jon Yakface Regul from DakkaDakka.com. Up first is rapid fire, so turn down that volume and buckle in, because it's a little bit wacky, but at least it's short.
Welcome to another edition of Rapid Fire, the roundtable discussion of all things gaming, coming at you with the speed of a charging and ranged boss grunions. I'm Geekly McNerdigan, your host. Today, as always, our panelists are Russ, I started Dakka Wakeland, and Rafe, I love Dakka Granger. And as a special guest today, we have John, I own Dakka Regul. Let's begin. Issue number one. In 1996, with a new house and a family on the way, little-known local favorite son, Russ, gleam-in-the-eye Wakeland, gave birth to the epic monstrosity now known throughout the world as one of the preeminent gaming communities on the planet. From the humble beginnings of a local league results tracker, it has become a juggernaut of unstoppable rumor-mongering, painting talent, and fan fiction. Question, what is your favorite Dakka memory and why? Rafe, I don't have boobs, go tell the noobs.
My favorite memory is when the big flaming...
Too much time, off. John! Sean's the man, he's can it can!
When the editor of White Dwarf got angry and never put it again.
Yeah, excellent! Russ, gleam in the eye, I think I'll cry!
Yeah, I liked when Jervis and Andy Chambers kept sending us emails to correct our content.
Interesting, interesting, but wrong! Clearly the highlight of the entire history of Dakka Dakka was when Drew, last name removed to protect the not-so-innocent, threatened to sick the FBI on John Wakeland for threats and intimidation. John's about as threatening as a wet teddy bear stuck in a fishery intake valve. Issue number two. One of the more interesting mechanics Games Workshop has ever devised was the concept that a model blocked twice its height. No matter where on the planet I've been, I've never met anyone whose aura was so intense I wasn't able to shoot through it with enough incentive. Question, what was your worst pet peeve from the 40k 4th edition rule set? John Factmaster Question Blaster.
Gotta be the FAQs.
Russ, close combat or rabid wombat?
Yeah, sustained close combat was just brutal.
Rafe, what's a 40k lame cache?
When models in combat would block the entire board.
And so, clearly the worst rule in all of 40k 4th edition was the dependence on dice. With the rumored working scale model 41st millennium weaponry included in the new edition, gladly this will be a thing of the past. Issue number three. Many religions and ancient traditions have an idea of how the world will end in the various heralds of our imminent destruction. The Hindus have the rider of Vishnu, who will destroy the earth with fire once we are ready to take the next step. The Aztecs believe we are living under the sun of movement, and in 52 years, Nanato, the rising eagle, will destroy us with a large earthquake. And of course, who could forget the seven seals of the Christian apocalypse? Question, what event do you believe will be the precursor of the end of the world? Russ, a space marine delay machine.
Frost or ice, not sure which one yet.
Rafe, the Norse gods will be at odds.
When Privateer Press makes a War Machine MMO, that might be the end of the world for me.
John, whack yak attacks the back.
Fingers crossed for zombies.
Answer is wrong! Only a bunch of sadly retrograde and unenlightened Philistines such as yourselves could come up with such sad answers. Any right-minded individual knows that the Zoroastrians have it right. When Sorshiant, born from 3,000-year-old sperm that's been floating in a lake all this time, comes and bathes the earth in molten metal, and we all get 3 days and 2 nights in heaven, all expenses paid. Issue number four. On the Privateer Press forums, lately a battle is raging between those who believe Hordes and War Machine are compatible and those who think in a head-to-head matchup one system is superior to the other. Question. Given this heated debate, who would win in a head-to-head matchup? The Emperor or Nagash? Rafe, the MP who? Nag what?
I vote Nagash.
John, what the hell am I doing here? I could be chilling with beer.
Nagash would bite his head off with his giant teeth.
Russ, the imp's my man if you stick with the plan.
Well, they're both technically undead, so I say it's a tie.
This one is literally a no-brainer, lads. One's not really dead but can't move, and one's really dead but romps all over the Warhammer world. Nagash one, Emperor nothing. Thanks again for listening, and good night.
From the dawn of time we came, rolling dice down through the centuries. We are the D6 Generation.
Here we stand, and here we fall. History won't care.
Well, welcome to episode 9 of the D6 Generation. I'm Russ Wakelin.
I'm Craig Gallant.
And I'm Rafe Hollywood Granger.
And today, we've got a very special guest on the show, Jon Yakface Regul from DakkaDakka.com. He's going to be helping us out on our big Dakka 40k spectacular episode.
Oh, yeah, sorry. That was my cue.
That was your cue.
Extravaganza.
Right. So our topic for today is pretty much Yakface from Dakka, Dakka Dakka itself, and then mostly Warhammer 40,000. This is going to be a long one, folks, so just sit back, relax, and pick out a 20-man squad, because you're going to get it done by the time this is over.
It's only the biggest sci-fi game on the planet.
That's it. And we'd like to dedicate this show to the Dakka Dakka community, both local and online. We'd like to thank you guys for all the support, games, and friendship over the years. And this episode is for you, so happy gaming, guys.
You guys all rock.
But first, it's time now for Achievements in Gaming. So first, Rafe, what have you been up to for the last couple weeks?
Okay. After many, many, many years away from an army-scale game, I finally was able to shrug off Russ's Jedi mind trick, and Craig does it best. Craig, what's that quote that you know so well?
I'm a Toydarian. Jedi mind tricks don't work on me.
Yes, I was able to finally execute that and pull the trigger on the army-scale game that's been itching at the back of my head for a while. So I've been listening to Podhammer. I really do like Jeff's show, and I listened ever since his Vampire Counts Army show, and I decided I'm going to go with a Vampire Counts Warhammer Fantasy Battle. And as you'll hear later on in the show, I mean, a Vampire Counts Army, I was like petrified to tell Russ, because he'd be like, I can't believe it, you're going back to GW.
This would be the first sign of the apocalypse, by the way, just for those, yes. For those of you who are following.
Right. That's right. So I secretly called up Craig, and he agreed to play test with me, and I've already played. I've put in the bag 2 Warhammer Fantasy battles, and I have to admit they were a lot of fun. I enjoyed the maneuvering again. I enjoyed the fleeing concept. I did enjoy the concept I'm going to make a female vampire. I'm already going to use for my Vergulf, I'm going to use a Warp Wolf, so I'm just excited to have that customability again. So I'm excited about that. You guys want to chime in at this point? You want me to keep going?
Are you excited about that?
Yes.
Okay. I'm getting a sense over the wire that you're excited about that. Is that correct?
Yes.
It's hard to read your emotion. Yeah. All right, so what's up next? I'll give you an achievement for that, by the way. There you go.
Yeah. So, yeah, I decided on a Vampire Counts Army. I built and painted some skeletons.
How do you like that plastic again?
The little twiggy skeleton arms were driving me nuts.
Yeah, those are new models, and they're cool but hard to deal with, I think.
But twiggy, yeah. Is a technical term.
But I'll tell you what I did. Last time I played Warhammer, I think I drove myself nuts with customization. And I would look at building a squad of 10 guys and just be like, try to, you know, I don't know.
Yeah, you can't find do that in Warhammer.
And here's a tip. Before you glue all those arms on in fancy poses, make sure they rank up.
That's right.
No, I mean, that's what I was concerned about. Right. So this time, I did a simple thing. Shield in front, sword pointing this way. And I did that with every single guy. Yes. And to be honest with you, I think that is what looks good about a fantasy army, is they're all kind of ranked up.
Yep.
So that made my life a lot easier. And I was so that was fun. Yeah, I enjoyed that a lot. But a weird thing came over me. As I'm painting the skeletons, I suddenly had an urge to pull out Cromac and paint him. I don't know. Don't ask me why. I can't explain it.
Did you paint the whole model? Paint,
what I did was I started to get the flesh tones built out on him, on both models.
Both forms.
He's got both poses.
He's
a
model that comes in two. He kind of goes werewolf on you.
Exactly. That might be why. The werewolf theme might have been playing out. Played Indiana Jones Lego with my son. Great fun game. If any adult gamer out there has a 360, hey Russ, do they make it for the PS3? I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's pretty much all platforms, including Wii.
All right, great. Just get those games. They're fun to play as an adult, and they're great to play with kids. I think Russ runs into this problem too. The only complaint I have is we adults tend to want to find every doodad and every goodie, and my son just wants to get to the level, you know. So, right. So I'm like, wait, I want to go, you know, explore this. Oh, another big news. I also purchased the Player's Handbook and the Monster Manual for D&D 4.0. And beginning to conceptualize with one of our friends, Dave Farr, to sort of co-DM a campaign. Not in the series that we have one campaign, but maybe to do serial writing, or so that way he can play as a player character too. And Russ and I are excited to check out the new online tools for D&D. But I just kind of read up, Russ, that there may be a delay on that, huh?
Yeah, that might be a little longer out for the rest of the year, so that's kind of sad, but we'll see what happens.
But that's okay. So I'm still happy I got those, and the books are gorgeous, I think.
Yeah.
What do you think, Russ?
I agree. They're beautiful. Beautiful.
Yeah, yeah.
You know how much I read about Privateer Press, and I think these are up there. They're just as good. They're really pretty.
All right, and my final segment is I want to do a segment on what I've been reading. I some of you might have catched, I collect comics, and I collect two types of comics. Comics that I just remember collecting as a kid, and the writing is really kind of stinky, and the storyline is no good, but I just collect them because it's fun. Right now, that's Amazing Spider-Man. So ever since J. Michael Straczynski left, Amazing Spider-Man, in my opinion, is boring. It's kind of written for kids. But some new adult comics with some adult themes, some great writing, great art, is Thor and Punisher. Did you know the new Thor? They had a reboot with the Thor. Do you guys know about that?
No. They started over again?
Yep. J. Michael Straczynski's carrying this one. Starts out with number one, and it's a really great read. Really good. Also, Lock and Key, you've heard me talk about. It's more of an independent comic written by Stephen King's son under a pseudonym. And I'm not going to go into all the comics I collect. I just want to go with what I think is a good adult fun read right now. And those are the ones.
Another achievement for reading. Yeah. All right.
Now, Craig? When you say adult, I always get this feeling like, is there like heavy sexual content in
graphic violence? I'm really glad you brought that up. Now, the Punisher is under the Max label, okay? Yeah. And it's not there for sex. It's there for like over-the-top language and things like that. No, what I mean is they might not be afraid to say the F word in there. Gotcha. Where appropriate. The graphics, the art, you know, they're not going to pull back. You know, okay. If somebody's getting skewered by a chainsaw, you're going to see it. And just the theme and the writing style is entertaining to read, like Powers was.
Yeah,
is a good example, gotcha. Craig.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I don't mean pornographic. No, I don't mean that.
Gotcha. I didn't think so, but I thought maybe we'd clarify.
Now, before I leave achievements in gaming, because maybe this is the first chance, sort of, for a negative achievement, what do you notice is not on my achievements in gaming, folks?
Wow.
That's right.
That's actually not negative at all. That's positive.
Yeah,
I'll give you two.
All right, I'm done.
Nice. Did you cancel your membership?
No, I'm going to cancel my membership with Lord of the Rings. Although it's making me really sad to do that because I feel like it was like my first home for a while. And wow, I think I'm going to wait one more month, and then if I don't play it, I'm going to cancel it.
All right. Craig.
Alrighty. very busy week for me, but I'd like to start by giving a shout out to the vocal fans we have in my spiritual homeland of Ireland. No potato jokes, please, you spalpeen. We get good emails from them all the time, and I can't remember the name, but somebody emailed us with why they're not leaving iTunes reviews.
Oh, yes.
And I back it up completely. Patty, that's right, Patty. Yep. The name of my first ever Irish bus driver.
There you go.
Why was it
so hard to remember? Because
that's kind of sad. I don't know. I think it's a pretty rare name in Ireland. I feel exactly the same way. I'm not a big fan of trying to maneuver through the iTunes website. But anyway. All right. I have a big announcement coming up, and I'll do that at the end here. First thing I did game-wise at the very beginning of this last little two-week period, the day after we recorded our last episode, I took out my Warhammer Fantasy Battles Empire Army, which is 2,500 models that got all crushed.
Models or points?
Points, yeah. That'd be a heck of a lot of models. Sorry about that. Feels like that many, because they were all crushed and destroyed in the move. I moved into a new house last year, and I rebuilt and touched up and cleaned the entire army. Then I took out my Chaos Warriors army, which is about 2,000 points. They're not even half done, but I started working on them again, trying to get them up to speed, including working on a two units of Chaos Hounds that I bought actually the Direwolf plastic kit with, and I'm using bits from the Chaos Spawn sprues to make them into Chaos Hounds, and it's coming out awesome. I'm really, really happy with the way those models are working together. And then I took out my Divine Wind Space Marine army, which was from second edition. That's how old that army was. 1998, I think I was working on that army. Which actually might be the very beginning of third edition. I can't quite remember. Yeah. I cleaned it. I put it all back together again for a little thing we'll talk about in a minute. And then I played some fantasy. I played a game with Rafe and then our friends Russ and Ragnar. Russ, you didn't even correct me with that. You're sitting right there. I just attributed you with an event you didn't take part in.
I hear fantasy, and I'm like, la, 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 la.
Okay. All right, then. Dave and Ragnar, and we played a four-sided game. I played Khemri. I really enjoyed that. And then I played another game that I'll talk about in a second, and I played Empire. I played Empire with you guys. I played Khemri the next time I played.
Yeah, which Russ and I weren't invited to.
No, you weren't, in fact. And I'll actually address that in a moment.
Yeah, I have secret spies at these events now.
I bet you do. I played some 40K. I was really excited about that. My Divine Wind versus Imperial Guard. And then a small chunk of that huge, cornate Berserker army that I have played against the Imperial Guard again. Really, really enjoyed it. And the big announcement is... Project Lojog revealed.
Woo!
Project Lojog is something I've been working on for quite a while, and it stands for the League of Just Ordinary Gamers. It's a group of people that you all know and love. These guys, these two, not you guys out
when
there.
When you say you all, he means
I mean Russ and
Hollywood. You don't know them at all.
Okay, our friend Joe and Russ's brother John and Pete. And it took me a while because I needed to find a system that they were all willing to get together to play, because John and Joe get together and play Dungeons and Dragons all the time, and they're all about World of Warcraft, so it's very difficult to pry them away from that.
That's an achievement, just getting them out of the house.
Yeah, and Pete, we've talked
like
about
vampires.
Pete, exactly. We've talked about Pete over and over again not playing any games. And basically what I've done, and I hesitate to throw this down as a gauntlet because I don't know for sure how it's going to work, but last Thursday, we started a Mighty Empires Warhammer Fantasy campaign.
Wow.
And it's just the four of us right now, because I was setting it up before Rafe decided he wanted to play Fantasy. But yeah, it's going to be the four of us, because these are three guys that I've known since, two of them since high school, and Pete and I met when my sister and his brother were playing soccer when they were tiny, because they're both much younger than we are, and we were very young too, because we met on the sidelines while they were playing sports, we were playing with Star Wars figures, and apparently that pattern has just continued in our lives. So guys that I've known for a really long time who don't play in a really competitive nature. They really just enjoy getting together anymore. They used to. But
at least Joe and John did.
Joe and John. But they're very much into just having fun and hanging out now, and we'll see how it works. But I'm super, super, super excited, because it's given me a chance to at some point on the website, I would really like to put up the campaign map.
Oh, cool. Yeah. Okay, we'll do that. Now, so here's my question, though. So we're going to want updates, because we want to see if this, you know, back in our last episode.
Yeah, I know. Play. I feel like the pressure.
A lot of people wanted to see if it could ever be done.
I know.
So you've got to end it, but you have to end it not only
to intended end. Yes.
We're going to write an ending now.
In order to claim this a success, I understand it has to go through to its intended conclusion.
Is there a plan number turn or something? Or?
No, you have to control 10 terrain tiles.
All right.
But if you have a city on any terrain tile, it counts as two. So you can do it with fewer than 10 if you're spending time and resources building cities.
All right, well, cool.
And And so I'll keep you up to date on that a little bit. And also, I have the IP neutral cards all set and ready to go. So far, only person has asked. If I haven't scoured, let's say I left one Games Workshop image on the set of cards, I would delete that if I were you, with the full and complete knowledge that you can go anywhere and find any image that you want for yourself,
right, for your own personal
use, and put it on there. These are just Word documents. They're very easy to adjust. You can adapt them for their 40K. They are for 4x4 tables, so you have to adjust a little bit. Although we did use them for our first game.
You use them in Lojong?
We did. We did use it. Awesome.
Cool.
But that's because fantasy requires less terrain, so spreading that much terrain over a 4x6 table actually worked out great.
Right. Hey, Russ.
Yeah.
Excuse me, Craig. I thought you were done. Yep. I know why I wasn't invited to the campaign. I mean, you can't have a random wraith in a campaign. So,
Disqualify yourself, and Russ, as he's pointed out, has gone through very successfully, I might add, his fantasy phase.
Yeah, I'm done with fantasy. Nothing wrong with fantasy.
No.
Just
And he's definitely got his bona fides with fantasy. He played over a thousand games with
just too many models.
Just lizard men.
Okay, so now. For my achievements in gaming, normally at this point I would give all of our iTunes shout-outs, but to get John on the show today, we had to get things together really fast and get a chance to go through my normal iTunes stuff. I would like to say thank you, of course, to everyone who's been giving us iTunes reviews.
It really helps.
We got like 6 more this week. They really do help. I know iTunes is kind of a pain to navigate, but the thing is, the vast majority of people find out about podcasts and get their shows through iTunes, and the more reviews you have, the easier it is for people to find you. So really appreciate folks who take the time to do that.
Help us, D6G fans. You're our only hope.
Hey, Russ, I happen to be on the iTunes reviews just for fun because I haven't been there in a while. And one guy writes that we are the poop of gods. I don't know whether to...
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Well, if you're going to be the poop of somebody, I would think
that's
the gods...
That's true. As far as poop goes, that's about as high as you can get.
If you're going to be poop, be gold-plated poop. That's what I say. Much like... Rafe, I did pick up the new Player's Handbook. It is gorgeous. It's awesome. Easy to read. Great stuff. It just reinforces everything we enjoyed in the demo we played. And again, if you're all interested in Dungeons & Dragons, this is a no-brainer, folks. Go grab it. I spent 2 weeks ago... the new 40K rulebook showed up at our local friendly gaming store, and I spent 2 hours just devouring it, essentially. And then, after I read that, which was fun, I did rush off to Craig's house, tell him all what I thought of it. And then I built, I decided I had to play Craig because, you know, basically, it's a major game. It's a huge system. I got to try it out. So I asked Craig if he'd play me, and Craig, you know, said he dug up his old Divine Wind. Well, I can trump his age because my Imperial Guard army, the models I put on the table were my original original 40K stuff. That Demolisher was bought the year it was released.
Yep.
I think it was like 93.
In fact, in one of its first games, that Demolisher had its turret blown off and landed on John's Farseer.
That's right. Back when turrets could fly across the battlefield.
That's how long ago we were talking about.
That was cool.
That was a great
Craig,
moment.
Remember when John and Russ would get in those brotherly fights?
You wouldn't want to be in the same room with these two when they played.
That's why I corrected you when he said he's not competitive. I said, maybe not when I'm not in the room. But I was looking forward to trying the game out, and so I did play last night, actually. I played 2 full games of 40K 5th Edition with Craig. The first game was against his my guard with lots and lots of tanks against his Marines, and then I fought his Khorne, and we'll have more about that later in the show. Also, got a little vid gaming in. For you strategy gamers, you'll probably remember a little game called Civilization, which some people have claimed took their entire early 90s away from their life. Civilization is an awesome turn-based game where you lead a civilization of, like, you know, Neanderthals up through discovering Alpha Centauri and all of history. And they just released a demo for Civilization Revolution, which is the first attempt at Civilization on a console. And it's coming to the Xbox as well as, I think, some other platforms soon. And the demo is cool. I would definitely recommend downloading the demo and checking it out. If you like Civilization, you'd try it. Also played some Lego Indie, as Rafe said. Good fun. And my daughters are loving it. And we have a big announcement to make, guys, today. Are you ready for this announcement there, Mr. Granger?
Ready.
All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to now announce that it is going to be possible for just any old person, group, or whomever to sponsor various segments of our show.
Ooh. Yay! You're welcome.
Basically, what's going to work is what this is going to give you is the ability to help us run the show, help us support the show, and keep the lights on and keep things going. And what we're going to do is we're going to put links up on the website probably in the next 24 to 48 hours, or maybe by the weekend at least. And what's going to happen is you go there and you can actually bid on which of the segments you want to sponsor. And you can sponsor any of the five major segments of the show, whether it's Rapid Fire or What's in the News or Did You Ever Notice or whatever. They'll all be up there. And you'll be
Hollywood Minute.
And you'll be able to purchase them for the upcoming episodes. It'll be episode 10.
Yep.
And it's going to start at $1. So if no one else wants anything,
you can pay a buck.
And you can basically, we'll mention your name or the name of your choice, and we'll also, you know, do one little sentence for you in character for whatever person is in that segment.
Yep. It could be Geekly McNerdigan or Hollywood or Announcer Man.
Did You Ever Notice Guy or whatever. And
I think he's the Grumpy Gamer.
Oh, the Grumpy Gamer, right. Yeah. He's so grumpy. I never want to ask his name.
He is totally grumpy. You don't want to talk to that guy.
So check that out and let us know what you think. And if you want to help support the show, that's a way you can do it. So we'll be looking forward to seeing how that works out.
We're excited.
And so that's our achievements.
Yep.
All right.
Hello, this is Big Troy McCauley from This Week in Wargaming. And you are fortunate enough to be listening to the D6 Generation.
And now, what's in the news? Trailers for the highly anticipated sequel to the wildly successful real-time strategy game Dawn of War have been cited on the internet. The trailers feature both gameplay and cutscene footage. If you've ever wanted to understand how a Mega Armor knob is to be handled with a Thunder Hammer, this one's for you. The extremely popular board game A Ticket to Ride by Days of Wonder will be coming to the Xbox Live Arcade this summer. Now players can become railroad moguls and build cross-country train routes with their friends online. Of course, it would be really great if after your opponent blocked your route with his little blue train cart, you could break out Marcus Phoenix and chainsaw his sorry excuse for a train halfway across the board and watch blood pass. Oh, wait, sorry. Shortly before the release of D&D 4 last week, Wizards of the Coast did release some details about the upcoming PC-based tools for the latest edition of the famous RPG. There will apparently be five different downloadable tools. The D&D Character Visualizer to customize the appearance of your character. Once created, you'll be able to print out a photo of your vision for your reference sheet and create a virtual figure for the game table software. The D&D Character Builder will assist you in creating and keeping track of your character's stats and powers. And, of course, the D&D Game Table software, which will allow players and DMs to play D&D with each other over the internet on a virtual battle board and feature built-in voice-over IP support. In addition, you'll have the D&D Dungeon Maker, which will allow aspiring DMs to create dungeons to either print out or use in the game table software. And finally, the D&D Compendium, which will be an online reference tool to keep all the D&D rules at your virtual fingertips. Sounds great, eh? But there's only one problem. The release of all these products have been delayed until sometime later this year. Here's hoping you can dungeon crawl online with your friends before Christmas. And that's what's in the news.
You come to us for your gaming news, rumors, analysis, and insight. And if you're not careful, you might even have a laugh or two.
Because that's how we roll at the D6 Generation.
Here at the D6 Generation, we would like to welcome Yakface from Dakka Dakka. Yakface, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Well, first I'd like to thank you for using my face on your icon, and now I'm going to pass it over to Rush. Rush, take it away.
Thank you, Sean. All right. We wanted to give chance, as our special guest today, Jon Yakface Regul is visiting us here from DakkaDakka.com. And we want to talk a little bit with Yak today about, you know, what he's doing on Dakka, what he's been doing. And I think, Yak, you wanted, Jon, you wanted to mention some things about what we've been up to on D6 Generation and what's been going on. So,
well, yeah, I'm a big fan of the show, and I've been listening. And you know, I was listening after Adepticon, which I was on the other podcast, 40K Radio, which you guys have talked about in the past.
Great show.
And you had commented on some stuff I had said, and I was listening. Uh-oh. I was like, did I really say that? And I had to literally go and fire up that other podcast.
Did I misquote him?
It wouldn't surprise me.
I might have.
No. You properly quoted me, but I was shocked to hear that I had actually said that. Oh. But then I realized, you know, as I'm sure you all know, when you start podcasting, you're talking, you say things, and then they just flow out of your mouth.
No, I mean everything I say.
So wait a minute. What was said? What was said?
I indicated that Russ may have sold the website and gotten out of 40K because of how expensive it was. Which is not really what I meant, because I mean, not that I know Russ personally in his life, but I think it was pretty clear to any of us that are on the website that his focus was going away from 40K, and that has a lot of, you know, that's not necessarily from any one angle. It was just clear that was happening, and he said when he sold the site that it was, you know, because he wanted to spend more time with his family, and that's all I was trying to say is, you know, you had different interests moving away from 40K, not that, and somehow, you know, income or expense, I should say, of 40K got into that when it that was just coming out of my mouth when it wasn't supposed to.
I thought, the way you said it, clearly, first of all, I didn't take offense because you were obviously at Adepticon, which is a major event. You probably had very little sleep. And,
that's true.
Yeah, and I thought sound jazz.
I kind of thought it was more of a jibe, actually, than an actually kind of quote me on a true statement. So I just kind of was poking fun back at you when I said,
definitely.
It wasn't cheap. So no offense taken. Either way, hopefully. No.
And actually, we all know that Russ left 40K because of me.
Cute evil laugh there. And I just wanted to mention that we had a huge event, actually, the day of the Dakka auction. And we were all in my pub, in my basement, rooting for you, Yak.
Yeah, we were very excited.
And we were really excited.
No, and I can't.
I was getting really scared because, you know, I put a pretty, you know, the way eBay works now is you put your maximum bid in now, and then, you know, it doesn't tell anyone, and it just basically, as people bid, it just, you know, they just keep jacking your own price up. So.
Yeah.
So I thought I had put, you know, an exceedingly large amount of money in, and then I was like, okay, we got this, because, you know, I knew it was going to be a bump, but then in those last few minutes, it was like insane. And I was here at work because it was like at 5 p.m. I work at 5 p.m., so I'm sitting here at work freaking out.
Well, there was a large bunch of geeks sitting in an Irish pub in New Hampshire. Shouting your name.
We're very excited, and you've done an awesome job with the site.
Absolutely fantastic.
Taking it to places where I only dreamt of. So good on you. I'm glad you won it, and I think the fans are better served, or well served, with you owning the site now.
I think they're better served.
I think
they're better served.
It's probably true.
Well, I would like to say, you know, first of all, the most important thing for me to say is that, you know, it's a co-ownership between me and another person. He goes by Lego Burner on the website. He doesn't like to give out his name, but basically,
probably smart.
Yeah, probably very smart, but I just don't care about privacy. So, so basically, you know, I didn't even know him before the auction. I had plans to have, you know, my roommate and some other hire programmers to do the work that I wanted to do, which I guarantee would have been about, you know, terrible compared to what it is now. And instead I got contacted by him, and he said, well, I'm going to try to buy the site, but he thought maybe I should partner with me. And as it turns out, I was willing to spend a lot more than he was, so he definitely would not have won the site with what he was willing to spend.
And is that partnership working?
The partnership is fantastic.
Awesome.
And you know, like, I've never met him besides, you know, speaking, you know, on the phone and over the internet. But he has, you know, amazing technical knowledge. And when he contacted me and we started talking about our ideas of what we wanted to do with the website, it was amazing, you know, how much the stuff was similar. And he has just fantastic ideas. And so, you know, basically it's been a dream. And he's put, you know, he's been working since, you know, we got the site in September. And pretty much nonstop all the time on upgrades, he never stops. And so, you know, I can't express how much of the great things that have happened are almost entirely up to him. And so I get to take all the credit, and he does all the work.
Well, you know, surrounding yourself with good people is a key mark of leadership.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
So
that's right. Yeah.
But that he's done it awesome. I mean, let's talk about some of the recent things you've added to the site, right? You've got, in addition to the site being faster and more responsive than it's ever been, having more users and more posts than it's ever had.
Yep.
More daily visitors than it's ever had.
Yep.
You also have this cool concept of the wiki, right?
Right. Absolutely. And that was Lego Burner's idea, because he's had experience with that. You know, we both, you know, one of the goals that I wanted was a way for everyone to publish articles, because back when, you know, you owned it, it was only the contributing members were able to to publish an article, and they kind of had to send it to you, and then you posted it. It was behind the scenes, and I definitely wanted to make it where there was a way that, you know, everyone could do it. And he was like, you know, I have this great idea with the, you know, wiki, and I was like, I had never posted on Wikipedia or altered anything, and I was baffled and confused, and he just like, you know, sent me some demonstrations, and the more he kind of solidified what it was going to be like, the more I was like, wow, yeah, that's absolutely perfect. And it's still a hugely underused feature, because it's new and a lot of people don't understand how to use it, but I think it could be amazing. You know, you were talking about on a previous show, you were talking about running a league using Google Documents, which is basically online documents where, you know, multiple people are able to access the same document and edit it. And that's basically, you know, the same as what a wiki is. It's an online page that multiple people can alter, and it's very, very easy to go in there and remove, you know, erroneous changes and ban a person if they start messing around with it. So you could easily take the Dakka article system, and you could post a league standing page or a bunch of league standing pages and have people come in and add their you know, games to it, and
cool.
and have that as your you know, league page, and we're totally down for that, and it's completely open, and anyone can do what they want, but a lot of people don't know about it or understand it and haven't used it yet, and hopefully, you know, as we move forward, we'll get more people interested in it, because I think it's a huge, huge resource.
Well, let's get the word out. Hey, there's like 2,000 of you out there right now. Go to Dakka Dakka and try the wiki.
Yeah, and now that we've actually used it. When we were putting our pictures up for the War Machine armors you painted, I made 3 profiles for Hollywood Craig and myself, and I put them on the Dakka wiki, and there's links from our site to there. So you can see how it works, and it was really easy. I think about a half an hour, I slapped together 3 army profiles, which used to take me like, you know, a day and a half.
Yeah, I remember those.
So that's awesome. So you can put your own, you put your pictures of your own armies up there, put your pictures of your club up there, all kinds of stuff.
Which, by the way, would be empirical evidence that since John's taken over, it's gotten better.
Good point.
Yeah. But anyway.
And we're still looking to make the article system easier to use, because right now uploading pictures is still a little time consuming. But one of the big secret things coming out soon, there's the last part of the stool, so to speak, will be the Dakka Gallery, which is going to be just as revolutionary as, in my opinion, as the article.
Is this a worldwide exclusive? Are you announcing that here first?
Well, if we've mentioned it. I'm just saying everyone knows. I mean, we have a gallery page right now, and it's basically the old gallery of when you own the site. It's just kind of sitting there as a temporary thing. And so it's clear that something new is coming, and that's what is the major thing that has been, you know, that's the next big
awesome.
Dakka release at some point.
Cool.
Hopefully for the 1 year anniversary, but no promises.
No good.
And I do believe that will, you know, really, really be something special when all three are working together, because it's really going to be the way they integrate the forum, the articles, and the gallery are just going to be great. So,
good.
Awesome. So keep checking back to Dakka, because it's just getting better and better and better.
Awesome. Now, I just heard John pronounce the word.
Yeah, he too. Did.
And he pronounced
it too.
So can you Dakka. Say that again for all of our listeners there, John?
I think it's Dakka, as in like a thumbtack, Dak.
Yes.
There you go.
So there's Dakka. 2 out of 2 Dakka owners agree. That is pronounced Dakka.
But I also believe that, you know, when you're dealing with a made-up word, that people are free to pronounce it.
Not only that, but the world is just made up of many different people.
Right.
And it doesn't take all kinds, but they are here.
I'd like to say that anybody who lives in any southern region, fictional or real, can just pronounce it the way they'd like as well.
Right.
Not the west or the east, but only southern.
Now, John, one last thing. Now, we've been critical of GW here on the D6 generation in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Have you? You think we've been fair in our criticism, or what are your thoughts on what we've been talking about?
I think you have been fair, honestly. But the thing that always irks me about a lot of the criticisms is a lot of the free passes that I feel that Privateer Press gets compared to Games Workshop. Mm. And what I mean by that is, Privateer Press does a fantastic job of, you know, dealing with its customers, and I don't think anyone can fault that. They're much more open than Games Workshop is, and maybe Games Workshop that has to do with the fact that they're a publicly traded company. But the one thing that I think that always comes up in my mind is that you have to remember that 40K and Fantasy have been around for more than 20 years, and so they're a game that it's been incredibly long running. And as you guys have said in your podcast, you know, gamers are fickle people. And so I don't think it's really surprising that anyone would get, you know, bored of a game over, you know, 5, 10, 15 years I would doubt that, you know, 10 years from now you guys will be playing the same games you're playing now. You know, it's probably something that changes over time. But I'm getting lost in my train of thought here. So basically what I am trying to say is, and I've completely lost.
Hey John, is what you're saying is that perhaps what's not been a fair treatment to us about GW, say, hey, there needs to be some feather in their cap for having a game system on two sides, fantasy and science fiction, 40K, for 15 years. But
right.
That's an incredibly great run.
Okay, and that's what I was trying to get to, is the Privateer Press has not hit the point that Games Workshop has, what I would like to call it, is the difficult point. And that is, there is a point where every game system hopefully hopes to reach the point where they have essentially filled out, you know, the shelves as far as the you know, stockists are able to stock. You know, basically
right.
Your entire line is filled up. And so you have, you know, 20 armies and you have a whole, you know, shelf space full of miniatures. And now what do you do to keep selling miniatures to people that already own your game? And at that point, you have really, really, really tough decisions to make. And basically, you either shut the game down and start another game up, or you basically change the game that you have, or change the unit you have, or do things to basically continue to make growth, because growth equals, you know, sales, and you can't just, you know, say that's it, because people don't like it when their game isn't supported. They don't like when there aren't new units. But if you already have an entire system full of stuff, you know, you're at a breaking point, and that's when you have to start basically making people angry by doing something.
Yeah.
That's a fair point.
And so, you know, the way the Privateer Press releases their stuff now about, you know, like units for every every army, you know, Games Workshop did that back in the day in Rogue Trader. You know, you'd pick up a White Dwarf, and there would be, you know, Dreadnoughts for every race, and there would be this for that. And obviously, it's a different era, but the thing still stands is basically when you get to the point where you have a whole army and everything's filled out, you know, it's kind of harder to release. You can't release just, you know, five more units for every race when you already have an entire range.
And the other thing to be clear on, too, is it's easier to release a model for every faction when you have four factions. It's harder when you have 12 or 20, right?
Exactly.
So
absolutely.
To reinforce your point, it's and the way Privateer dealt with it, I mean, they've starting to cheat, too, a little bit, that idea, because, first of all, the Pirates release, you're not very familiar with their system, but the Pirates release this winter was a Merc release that was only one faction, really. I mean, all the factions could choose. It was kind of like a Dogs of War book, really. But that was something that wasn't really for all the factions. And now they have Hordes, which is sort of a neat trick. The two games play together, so there's really nine factions in the world that can fight each other, but it's almost like four factions work together and four factions work together. So you get new Horde stuff or you get new War Machine stuff. So it is sort of like now the world's in half. So that's how they're dealing with it. But you're right. Mm-hmm. As their game grows.
Yeah. And that longevity point is a good one, too.
And that longevity point is a very good one. That's fair.
Different ages of the companies, different growth stages.
And that's why I don't think it is fair to criticize GW for coming out with new rule sets like 5th edition, which is going to require a lot of gamers to rethink their lists. It's going to make them maybe some units they used to love have to be changed. Maybe they got to buy new models. Maybe they're going to want to change whole armies because their playstyle's got to change. But I think that has to happen. One, because the company's got to stay viable and keep the rules fresh and keep you excited. And as you've said before in the forums, to keep people tactically challenged. I got to rethink my strategy. It's not the same old strategy I've been using for 10 years. I got to rethink the whole battle strategy. But also to keep the game modern, because there are games that, as time goes on, what we come to expect from our games in terms of play time and how many tables I got to reference and all these other things changes. And the kind of war game we're willing to play today, the war game consumers willing to play in 2008, is very different than the kind of thing a war game would expect to see on the shelf in 1989 or 92.
Right.
So I think it's all very good points.
I'd like to add something to that too, but Craig, did you want to say something?
Yeah.
Okay. You know, John, that's an excellent point in the fact that it made me think of, and this is going to come out as a criticism, but I'll wrap it up. It's not a criticism, is that Privateer Press has the fortune in the type of game they designed being skirmish / magic, my term. They put out one new Warcaster, one model. It's a whole new game. Right. But GW makes army scale games. I mean, even Russ and I, which you'll get, we'll hear about later on the show, we miss the army scale. So I think their advantage is also their disadvantage, because they can't just put out one new leader. What's that going to do? Like you said, John, people, once they have their army, now what? GW has to produce a whole new army line.
Right. Well, I'm going to go here. I'm going to go ahead and make a prediction about War Machine and Privateer Press.
It's on the record.
And, you know, I don't know exactly when this is going to happen, but there will come a time when, lo and behold, Privateer Press is going to release some sort of army-scale game using the miniatures they currently have.
Hmm, interesting.
I think that's probably.
But I'm with you. Okay, you heard it here first. Jon Yakface made the prediction. There will be a war-scale 40. And here's the question, though. Will it suck as bad as the war-scale confrontation?
I don't know, but I'm just thinking about from a business perspective, and they will reach a point, because you're already seeing it with players, War Machine players that want to play 1,500 points, they want to play, you know, these incredibly large games, because people want to buy their miniatures, they want to keep buying miniatures, and they want to use those miniatures that they buy, and that's the both the boon and the curse that Games Workshop has run into, and that's why they released Apocalypse. It's what some people want to do, and as a company, you know, where are they going to go when they've released the point where they have, you know, enough units that everyone's pretty much bought? It's like, okay, we got to get people to buy more, and so I think that will eventually happen.
I think you're. In fact, I'm going to name it. It's going to be the Apocalypse Equivalent. War Machine Apocalypse Equivalent.
It'll be called Apotheosis 2 or whatever they call it. All right. Anything else you want to take as a task on there, John, or are we good?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I live out here in Los Angeles, and I am literally sitting in Hollywood right now. If I go outside of my workplace.
That's gross.
If I go outside right now, I look up, I will see the Hollywood sign. I just want to say that, you know, to me, what Hollywood is, you know, you see Hollywood on TV, and you think the glitz and the glamour, but in reality, anyone who lives here knows for a fact that the real Hollywood is basically garbage and transvestites. So,
great. Okay. I've changed my mind. I'm going to call you Hollywood from now on.
I like Hollywood better than Bollywood now. I'm back.
So I have to say that every time, you know, you reference your nickname, that's what I think about. I think about the endless piles of trash that are on the ground here, and the transvestites I buy every day.
You know what's funny, and I wish we would have done this podcast a few weeks ago, because I was in Hollywood for a conference. It would have been cool to meet up in person. But, you know, he's right. I never saw so many homeless people sort of, like, right there in Hollywood.
Right.
So, yeah. Oh, boy, I picked a bad moniker.
You're stuck with it now, baby.
Yeah, I guess so.
All right, Joe. Well, thanks for taking the time to chat with us.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much. And I think we're going to talk about some 40K now. I'm excited.
I think we might be. Let's get into it.
And now for a taste of things to come.
An even playing field. A clear set of rules. And a good roll of the dice.
Dice are our vice. We are the D6 Generation.
Well, now we'd like to talk about Warhammer 40,000 5th Edition. We're very excited about this. We got a chance to see the game early and play a couple games and go through the book. And we're very excited to have with us today, as you already know from earlier in the show, Jon Yakface Regul from DakkaDakka.com. How are you doing today, Jon?
I'm doing pretty good. Thanks for having me.
Welcome, Jon.
And
welcome aboard.
So we'd like to thank, first of all, the Game Castle, our local miniature wargaming store, friendly local gaming store. They are kind enough to not only, you know, a lot of stores across the country now got the 40K 5th Edition rulebook in early. And at the Game Castle, they're kind enough to let it sit there amongst their tables and let people try the game out and play it.
Big props to the Game Castle.
So we
want
to thank that. And Yak, do you want to give any props out? I know you've had a chance to look at the book. Where did you look at it?
I just went down to the Los Angeles Battle Bunker, which is 45 minutes from my house, and commandeered it for 3 hours.
Nice.
Nobody likes a braggart, Jon.
Now, so you haven't had a chance to play it yet, though, Jon, have you?
I have not had a chance to play it. No, okay. It's all Theory Hammer for me right now.
All right, cool. Well, we have had a chance to play a couple games, so we'll try to sprinkle that in amongst our, and we'll give more of that in a little bit. I just wanted to go in, just to kind of confirm that we're excited to talk about this. And we also, this panel here, it'd be hard-pressed to find a more experienced 40K panel today talking about this. Of course...
And Rafe.
And Rafe. And Hollywood. Hollywood, of course, has played quite a bit for many years. Craig and I have played since Rogue Trader. For newer listeners to the show, I ran a store selling only Games Workshop products, been on tournaments. And, of course, we have our special guest today, Jon, and Jon, you have a little bit of experience with 40K. You want to talk
just
about some of the things you've been involved with?
Well, I started playing in 1992, Rogue Trader era, and just have played since then, run a few leagues, run a couple tournaments, small-scale tournaments back in the day. And since then, got on the Dakka Dakka and moved on since then, and have worked with the Adepticon crew to help them create FAQ for their tournament last year and the year before, which went pretty well. And just pretty much 40K is my game.
Now, so. for people not in America, what is Adepticon? How
Adepticon
big is that?
Adepticon is, I would wager, probably the best tournament in the world. And obviously, it's comes from my point of view.
Completely unbiased, though.
From the international guests that we've had from Games Workshop, and they could just be blowing smoke up our skirts, so to speak, they've all said basically this is something that you don't see anywhere else. So, I think it's pretty amazing.
It's awesome.
It's in Chicago, and I fly out from California, so obviously I think it's pretty good tournament.
Yeah, and if awesome. You haven't been to Adepticon, the team tournament's like 400 players, right, or 300, 400 players?
Yeah.
Like that, in one room. I think it's the world's largest tournament, and John's been a little modest here. The FAQ that he wrote, which originally I think came from some of the Dakka FAQ you started working on quite a few years ago and sort of built up,
yep.
Right? And then it became sort of the de facto FAQ for Adepticon, and now it's been going around the world, and people talk about it. I don't know if it's quite at the level of the Direwolf FAQ for fantasy, but it's getting there. So John's got a lot of experience with the rules, so we're excited to hear his opinions on the fifth edition stuff.
Credit where credit is due, man.
That's right. That's a lot of typing.
That is true, and I'd like to thank my work for giving me lots of downtime.
Nice.
We won't tell anybody.
That actually is a big deal, because remember Russ, Craig, and I thought about trying to do that way back in the day, and we just thought it was too monstrous a task. So I can't even imagine Yakface going through that. Yeah. This is Hollywood speaking, of course. So
literally, like 8 months. It's just, just constant work. But, what cracked me up is when we put out the FAQ, some people on other message boards, there was a guy saying, that FAQ is crap. I could do a better one in a weekend.
Yeah, right.
And I said, I was just thinking to myself, man, if you could do that, please.
Please, anybody but me, right?
Now, is there any sense of frustration now that you did the FAQ and 5th edition is coming out with some huge changes?
That's not how I work.
Excellent.
I'm ecstatic. I would say of the rulebook section, I would guesstimate about 85% or more of the questions in the rulebook section are just completely answered now.
Nice.
So
awesome. That puts you at the fifth level of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, by the way.
Right.
So go ahead.
Yeah. I really look forward to to actually, you know, editing it for 5th edition and just basically throwing out whole
throwing
chunks
out
of it.
95 pages of the 100 or whatever.
Yeah, it would make me really happy, strangely awesome. Enough. So.
Now, let's talk about that. So GW had a lot of challenges coming at them into going into 5th edition, not the least of which are annoying critical fans like the D6 generation, who we've been pretty vocal about it in the past, but on the internet. But one of the there are a couple of challenges. First of all, you know, GW made this pledge back in 3rd edition that they would not release an edition that deprecated the current rule books, right? So the
I think that's whatever, the wrong word, but we'll just move on.
Okay. We'll replace, throw them out, ignore them, replace them, whatever. So they had to come out with a rule set that would still support the old codexes. And this is really the first release for 40K that's come out in a market where there's actually decent competing products for them.
Yeah.
You know, when 4th came out, War Machine was still a baby. Flames of War was still little. You know, 1843 wasn't even a gleam in anybody's eye. There were no other major games that were actually that could draw you off. Now, since then, I mean, it's arguable how many people have been pulled away from 40K to other games, but they're definitely out there. Many of them are considered quite good. So they're coming in, you know, how are they going to respond to these new competitors? How are they going to keep it backward compatible? And how are they going to address the need that fans had, like Dakka had, to write an 80-page FAQ to solve it? So, and one other thing I wanted to mention before we get into the nuts of the details of this is, when I'm talking about this book and my feelings on it, I'm looking at it as if I'm a new player to 40K. When I say that, I mean I'm not coming at this with the challenge of, oh my God, I just spent $500 on a recent army, I don't want to have to convert it all. I don't think that's a fair way to review a rule set. I mean, yeah, we could debate all day whether or not that you have to redesign some of your armies.
Unit A doesn't work anymore. And
what I'm really looking at this thing as is, how, if I were coming in now and I had to buy a new army anyway, how good is this game now compared to other games out there I could choose from? And how good is it at doing the job it's designed to do, which is provide an army scale sci-fi combat with a wide variety of unit choices, a wide variety of customization, and a wide variety of armies. So that's how I'm looking at it. I guess that's how everybody else is planning on looking at it, right?
Yep.
Yes.
All right.
Absolutely.
So let's talk about the book itself. Let's talk about the quality of the product. So, John, you had a chance to hold it for several hours. Mm-hmm. What did you think? What were your first impressions of the hardcover monstrosity?
I was really impressed overall with the book. I mean, I haven't been unimpressed, I would say, with any of the rule books in the past, you know, compared to, you know, the Privateer Press books, you know, which I'm sure you'll bring up. It's, you know, not full color the whole way through, so it definitely isn't the same. But I would just say the way the book is laid out, in terms of the rules, especially is very different from my first look at it. I felt like before, where they made a real effort to, you know, make all the rules written in a way that was like, you know, cinematic or funny, or, you know, just have a little, you know, quips or something in there, a lot of that has been stripped away in favor of a more precise language, including, you know, more precise diagrams, diagrams that cover kind of weird situations a little bit better. And so while that may be a little harder for a new gamer to hop into, I think it shows a new focus, which I think is much appreciated by a lot of people who have been playing the game.
That's a good point. The change from the cinematic to the rules.
Yeah, I didn't catch it, but that is a good point, John, because I had looked at it, and you're right, there's less sort of silly commentary and much more analytical thing. And just to give the basics here, right, this thing is 320 pages. It is hardcover. And you're right, I'm going to mention the color thing. And it's not because the book isn't awesome. It is a great-looking book.
Which, for those of you playing along at home, this would be the sign of the apocalypse.
The book, it looks awesome. It's of the 320 pages, I'd say roughly the first half is rules, and it's black and white. And the second half is, you know, the little two-page spread for each race, the background of the 41st millennium, the hobby section. That whole thing is colored with actually some really nicely done two-page artwork and some other great new art.
A lot of new art.
There is a lot of new art. Yep. Not as much as I'd like, still some recycled stuff. But so the only thing I would ding it on is, again, I am getting spoiled by, D&D being full color now for the last couple, and by Privateer Press. It just feels like, you know, GW's the biggest guys in this industry that could do full color. But that's a minor nitpick. It's still a beautiful rule book. And I know they do have sort of an art style thing with the black and white. So, John, you made a really good point. It's organized extremely well from the idea that this is actually not only a way to learn the rules, but it's also a reference work.
Right.
I thought, like, all the morale rules are one spot, whether it's morale for tank shock, whether it's morale for fleeing, whether it's morale for losing combat. They're all on one page with all the modifiers. You have to flip back and forth and go, oh, well, it's a tank situation. Where's that morale rule? They're all in one spot, and I think it's really easy to find things.
Yep, absolutely.
Well, I would say if you went and compared it to the 4th edition rulebook in terms of layout, it's actually, I don't know, I'd say about 90% similar. So it, in a way, it makes it, like, if you knew where that section is in 4th edition, when you go and try to find the same rule in 5th edition, it's almost in the same place. So.
Well, that part is true, but I found in 4th edition, every once in a while, there'd be one little exception that was somewhere else, and in 5th, I don't see that. Maybe I could be misremembering, but I didn't really notice that as much.
And one thing that's noticeable is that they have kept up on their pledge, so to speak, of removing ancillary rules from the rulebook. So there's no kill team, there's no specialty, and some people may, you know, hate that, but you know, that's their new plan, which is basically to keep this as a basic rule set for the game, and then to add stuff for, you know, small point games or large point games in additional supplements like Apocalypse, or one would assume, you know, a small point supplement coming out sometime in the future.
Yep. And I also mentioning the rules layout, it was written by the same gentleman, I think, primarily who wrote the fantasy book, right?
Yeah.
And that's what I wanted to point out. I wondered what you guys thought about that.
Well,
you know, on the theory that the, you know, I don't know, and correct me if I'm wrong, but is there a belief, John, in the Dakka communities or perhaps just in the world that the Warhammer rule set it was before 5th edition a tighter rule set, or no? Is that not a belief?
Are we talking about Warhammer Fantasy Battle?
Correct, yes.
Well, I don't play fantasy, so but I would definitely say that you know, most people I've seen on the internet talking about Warhammer Fantasy is that, you know, it's gotten better with each edition. I haven't seen anyone saying, you know, it's gotten worse in terms of tightness of rules. Some people I think still like some of the previous editions the way they play, but in terms of clarity and that standard, I think that they feel like the game is improving with each edition.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on that, and I should say, too, I have not seen the book yet, so in case I speak and it's not in the book, I'm sure the audience will correct me, but with the same author, I think that's a very good sign of bringing 5th edition back to a tight rule set. What do you guys think?
Well, the layout is very close to the Fantasy 7th edition book.
Right.
Almost exactly in terms of what parts are color, what parts are black and white, where you find things. The index, which I love, I'm a big index guy and a glossary guy. The index is A in the very, very back of the book, even after the quick reference sheets and the template, you know, photocopy page or whatever, which is very nice because you have to flip through to find
Yay.
It. And I think in 4th, and I might be wrong about this, John, you can correct me, but I think in 4th, like if you were trying to find out the fleet of foot rule, fleet of foot didn't appear in the index, but the words like special rules did. So you had to kind of know. But in this one, all the special rules are broken out in their separate areas, so you can even find, if you're trying to look for a rapid fire or a fleet of foot, it goes right to that page too. Which is really nice, because again, it's just so much easier to find those little nitpicks.
Yeah, I'm not sure, because, you know, once you get used to the rule book, you stop looking at the index, so I can't remember what the 4th edition index looks like.
From
anymore.
Memory, it's page 55, man, just stop looking at the index.
Exactly.
And I also noticed, I felt, and Craig, you looked at the book a little bit too.
I quite often.
The rules seem to be, and I think John already alluded to this, clearer in how they're written. There's a very clear example with almost every rule, and some really nice diagrams.
Yeah, and every time we came up with a question, it was very clearly and obviously dealt with in the rules book.
Yeah.
If two games we played yesterday, and not a single time did we come up with a rule that we thought was vague.
Right.
And, exactly. And the diagrams.
That's a great sign.
The diagrams in particular. I mean, that was two games. Russ played with the same army, and I played two different armies.
1,500 point Imperial Guard. Because I had to find out if the tanks had been nerfed, as the rumors were saying.
And
Craig brought...
I played Space Marines for the first game, which with traits, I had troops for
lots
bikes
of
for
bikes,
troops.
Very assaulty.
Which is huge in the new edition. And then I played a Cornate Berserker army with a bunch of the weedy little new demons.
And this
demons.
Is the newish Chaos Codex with sort of the generic demons, right?
Exactly.
Is that your Berserker army you only played once before?
Yeah. I played with it twice now.
We're excited about that.
So
you pay attention. I like him.
So, Russ.
Yes.
not to get you nervous, but do you are you going to tell us, like, do tanks get nerfed and things like that?
Oh, yes. Or?
We're going to be very honest. We're going to be honest. Because there's some things that I would say overall it was a positive experience.
Once again,
a sign of the apocalypse.
Okay.
So let's get into the mechanics, experience. And then we'll talk about it. As we go through each mechanic, we'll try to give examples from our our conflict here as it went along. So one of the rumors going around, let's talk about movement, which is a pretty simple thing, but there was a big change to movement, which is now every infantry model
and
cavalry
and vehicles with a weapon skill
and walker vehicles can run.
That's the huge thing, is the sentinels zipping around the board.
Right. So that means you can, so think about how fleet of foot used to work. So instead of shooting, you can move an extra D6 inches, and when you move those extra D6 inches, you ignore terrain. If you choose not to shoot, however, and you cannot assault either if you run.
Right.
But if your unit has the old fleet of hoof, claw, foot rule,
which they just call fleet now,
you can run and then still assault. So basically the deal is now regular guys are as fast as fleet of foot guys, but fleet of foot guys still have the assault option after they run, whereas regular folks don't.
So, and a great point on run, which I thought was awesome, especially facing two template of Doom tanks, is that deep strikers can run on the turn they deep strike.
Yes, and you know what's great about that? So Craig and I were talking about that. I'm like, I don't know. You think it's in the book? Let's check it out. Right in the deep striking section, it says, you may not move, you may shoot, or choose to run instead. It's not even
debatable. Very clear. It's not like they forgot to mention it in wherever it needs to be mentioned. Right.
So, John, what is your take on the run thing? How do you think that's going to do things?
I think it's a great addition. One of the things that, Phil Kelly, when he came to Adepticon, was talking about that, movement is the lifeblood of any good war game. Setting up all your miniatures and then rolling dice to kill each other, Tau versus Imperial Guard, standing, doing nothing, is by almost everyone's standard a pretty dull game.
Yep.
And the more you have to move around, the more you have the options to move around, the more dynamic a game can and will be. And so I think that helps that idea. And I think some of the changes, people may be screaming, well, assault armies are just going to come across and completely destroy your army now because everybody can run. But I think they've made some changes to the way that assaults work that even when assault armies reach your lines, shooty armies still have a
Absolutely.
Chance.
Absolutely.
And that's an awesome point because one of the things, and I know I was guilty of this, I will say prior to actually reading the entire book, is you can take any one of these changes and just go on for days about how it's going to break the game. You have to look at 5th edition in total to really appreciate how it all works together. Because
it's much more elegant, I think.
Yeah, yes, assault armies are faster. But as we're going to get into now, line of sight is very different, and there's really no place to hide. And the reason for that is 5th edition goes to true line of sight. And I was skeptical about this, but let's talk about how it's going to work. So basically, you're supposed to look from where the model's eyes are, or if it's a vehicle, from where the weapon mount is, and you look, and whatever you can see, you can see. And area terrain, so like a forest template, or whatever other things you might have, or a building with windows, if you can see between the trees of a forest template, you can shoot through there. And if you can see between the window of a building, you can shoot through there. If you can see between the legs of a walker, you can shoot through there. If you can see between two models that are pushed base to base, but you can see between the two bodies, you can shoot through there. So basically, the only way you're not going to see something is if there's a physical object.
Like a wall.
Big enough, like a mountain or a wall or a very large hill or a tank blocking line of sight. And that's kind of a big deal.
That's a huge deal. I felt it was a huge deal as the Berserkers.
Right, so when you were deploying, especially in the game where you knew you were going to have second turn, which we'll get to in a little while later. He's looking at this table, and it's a table. It's got all kinds of what would have been a lot of area terrain on. He's got nowhere to hide, and I've got two battle cannon demolisher looking down on him. All this other thing. So we had to look at that.
Brutal.
Yeah. So how it works is, if you shoot though through all this stuff, if the model you're shooting at is partially obscured, or you're shooting through another unit to get him, or shooting through area terrain to get him, he does get a 4+ cover save.
And that's all over the board. There were 4+ cover saves going on the whole game.
So what ends up happening is, there are 4+ cover saves going on everywhere.
In addition to your armor save?
Well, you have to choose your save. You have to choose your save, but imagine
you're
this.
Talking battle cannons and las cannons. You take what you can get.
And if you're a guardsman, it's awesome.
Yeah.
Because now you've got a 4+ cover save all over the place. So basically, while you can see everywhere on the board, in many, many cases, shooting is roughly half as effective because only half your shots are going to do something. Right?
It felt very cinematic. This is one example. A squad of 5 bikers with a flamer charging up on a guard command squad in a crater.
Yep.
And it took 3 rounds of shooting with the twin link bolters to take 2 of their guys out, and eventually I had to go in there with the flamer and burn them out.
Right. Just, oh, cool!
It felt much more like, I mean, odd to use the term realistic, but it felt more real. Like these guys were hugging the crater and they were taking advantage of every little nook and cranny, and I literally had to go in there with the weapon that didn't allow them the save.
Right, and the other thing that was kind of cool was that. You know, in a normal situation where the whole army's hiding from you behind the area of terrain and whatnot, as the shooting guy, you're frustrated because, oh, I can't do anything this turn. You know, or you can fire 1 multi-laser or something. Now, you're half as effective, but at least you're shooting.
Yeah.
So now I'm just firing like crazy. Yeah, I'm only, but at least I'm doing something and occasionally getting lucky and killing somebody.
Yep.
And it does much more cinematic. There's lasers flying everywhere. There's bikes zipping all over the place.
It felt like there was more action and maybe a little less damage going on because you got to try more, but it was less effective. Yep. But in a good way, in a kinetic way.
And I was very much vocal about the true line of sight thing, and I think though after seeing it in action, and again, so here's an example of, you gotta look at the game in total. You got the run thing, they can get to you faster, but there's a lot less places to hide now due to the area terrain thing. And all models block line of sight, we should mention this real quick, but if you shoot through a unit, either if it's your friendly unit, you'll give the guy a 4+ cover save.
Yep.
And one last thing about that is, there's this whole thing on the internet about the debating rule. John, you probably heard about this rumor that there's a rule in the book that says if you debate, that the guy argues with you. There's a really good example that clears it up. It's not as sort of weird as it sounded initially on the internet.
Well, wait, spell it out. I don't know what the debate rule is.
Well, there was a rumor that if your opponent disagreed with you being in cover, they could just take 1 off your cover save.
And okay.
Really, it's very clearly pointed out in the rule. It basically is, if a squad is half obscured or half in cover or more, they get a cover save. If they're not half in, they do not get a cover save. If the squad is on the line, basically, 50-50, half in, half out, they get the cover save, but it's 1 worse. That's exactly how it works.
Well, to further that, because it's a little more complicated, it's basically, you know, you see if the target squad is 50, the majority of them are in cover from the majority of the firing models in your unit. And so that's why it can get very, you know, complex, because technically if you wanted to break it down, you have to check the line of sight from each individual model. But most of us are going to say, well, forget that. So anytime where it's like on that line of like, oh, I'm not sure, you can just say, forget it. We're going to take the cover save, but just make it -1. Right. So a 5+ cover save instead of a 4+ cover save. But for those who are really anal or very, you know, very, you know, important situation, you could still count each individual firing model and see if the majority of the models are, you know, in cover.
Right.
Hmm.
But it's a nice mechanic they got in there, which doesn't feel quite as bad as Dice It. You know what I mean? Once you get your cover save, it's not quite as good.
Right.
Now, let's go quick to the shooting phase here real quick. So what happens? So we've got the guy. We've got him in our sights. We know if he's going to get cover or not. And we know about that area turns a block line of sight. We know there's plenty of cover saves. When you fire at somebody...
new option.
There's one new option the defender has, which is called going to ground. So basically, they shoot you, they roll to wound.
For instance, a squad of Marines rapid firing against a small squad of guardsmen.
Right. And I get to wait and see after he shoots, I get to wait and see how his wound rolls go, and then I can say, oh darn, I'm in trouble, I go to ground. And when you go to ground, it means basically your cover save gets 1 better. So if you're already in a 4+ cover save situation, you go to a 3+ cover save, and if you're out in the open, you go from no cover save to a 6+ cover save.
But
now, I like that, but why do you get to see how the shots and the wounds go first before you go to ground?
Because it's such a huge penalty, as you'll see in a second, that if you didn't, then no one would ever do it.
Right.
And it's cinematic. Okay. It's like, here they come, crap, and then you die.
See how bad it is, and then, yes, what you do is you go to ground. But the downside of going to ground, as John has pointed out, is you lose, you're basically pinned the next turn, but they don't call it pinned. You've gone to ground. So next turn, you cannot move, shoot, or assault.
I see. Okay.
So you give up your next turn in order to survive.
But cleverly, they don't call it pinning. Here's another example of good wording. They call it going to ground because some units are immune to pinning. So when you make a pin check, if you fail a pin check, you go to ground, right? But if you're immune to pinning and you choose to go to ground, you've still gone to ground and have to affect it. So that's another great use of...
And the rule book says that any time in the rules that something states that it causes pinning, it causes going to ground. Right. So that way they cover their
they did a good job of that.
So that's good. See, that's a good indication for me. Somebody who's been away from a long time, and what I've enjoyed about the Privateer Press rules, sounds like 5th edition's changed that. There's no longer this confusion, this extrapolation you have to make. Does go to ground mean the same as pinning? They thought of that, and they figured that out, and they gave it technical terms.
Right.
Well, we hope. But there's still a huge chunk of information to be found out, and that's how they're going to convert the codexes. So, and that's a big question mark that we should get to at some point. But
that's a good question. Yeah, I want
to
hear about that.
That is going to be an interesting question. We'll have to get to that when we get to it. So now when you shoot, though, there's a couple different things here, and what you want to think about is how fantasy works, because I think this part of the game was inspired by fantasy a bit. So what happens is shooting out the enemy is basically you've got line of sight. Any models that have line of sight in your unit to at least one model in the enemy unit can fire, and any models in your unit that have range to at least one model in the enemy unit can shoot. Okay? But here's the thing, it's like fantasy. Who can be hit in the enemy unit? Anyone. So even if my unit only has range to one model, and I've got, 10 lasguns in it, and I fire 10 lasguns and I get lucky and hit 3 marines, I can kill 3 marines. Doesn't matter where they are in the unit. It's just like fantasy. If I can barely make it to the range of my bows, and I only get the first rank, it doesn't matter. Guys fall off the back rank wherever I want to kill them. It doesn't matter if I can only see one model. If there's a 10-man squad and one guy's out from behind the mountain, and the rest of us are behind the mountain, and I hit that one model with 3 las cannons, 3 guys die from anywhere the defender chooses.
No, 3 guys get hit and probably wounded.
Right.
But because most of them are behind cover...
Well, it gets cover saves, right?
Exactly.
I should overstate it. But basically, what I meant to say was...
You were living in a guard paradise there for a moment.
But he gets his 3 cover saves, right? You're right. But then when he picks his casualties, anybody can die from the unit. So the big deal is, what I think that solves, and correct me if you think I'm wrong here, John, is it solves the whole idea where... In the last edition...
Rafe, you and I aren't allowed to talk if we disagree.
Or you guys...
That's funny.
If you angle your models in such a way, you could snipe off important models from a unit, right? So if there's a unit sitting there in 4th...
Yeah.
Yes, this is the best change in the game, in my opinion. Well, the range and line-of-sight sniping were this ridiculous holdover from... 2nd edition where it was a squad-based game, and then they went to 3rd edition, and 4th edition they couldn't get it out of, from a model-based game, and then they went to these new editions, and they were clearly pushing towards a squad-based game, but they could not quite get out of that mentality of measuring per model, and so you ended up with these stupid situations where you had to worry about where your heavy weapon model was placed in your unit, because your opponent might be able to cause, just the amount of casualties and within range to kill the 3 guys in the front of your squad, so... That was ridiculous, and I've been, praying that this would change, and so I'm very, very, very happy. Very happy to see that this has finally been implemented.
Absolutely. You know who's not happy? The Matrix gamers, because this is where that came in.
Yeah. Yes.
It was all the geometry, and if I go 3 inches to the left, I can only see that guy, and that's all gone now, which is awesome.
Right. That is awesome.
And another nice bonus for this is it makes squad deploying a little easier, because in our game last night, there's this nice berm, right, and I couldn't get my las cannon to fit in the berm. But it's okay. You put the las cannon team outside the berm. As long as the majority of the squad's in the berm, the whole unit gets the cover save, even though the las cannon's hanging out there. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And as he shoots them, I can pick guys off from behind the berm. Doesn't matter. So just from in terms of deployment. So
there's no agonizing over model-by-model placement, and you can make your army look cooler on the board.
Right. So it's just a little more flexibility, and it gives it's sort of an abstraction because your model's location is roughly where he is because things are kind of moving and flowing. But
You know what? I'm wondering if it really is, because isn't the abstraction in fantasy, you shoot the front rank and the guys from the back rank fill the front rank? Is that what they're saying here? The guys from the back run up, grab the last cannon?
Yes, but you don't kill the last cannon, so yeah, I guess so.
Well, you can't, you could,
that's exactly what they're saying, actually.
Yeah.
They even use that example in there. But they've said that in the last 2 editions as well, but now they've finally fully implemented it.
Right.
I see.
Now, another big change to shooting is how blast deviation works. You want to cover that one? Who wants to take that one?
I'll take it because it affected me. Blast deviation is great because, well, I thought it was great, but my weapon ballistic skill is a little bit better than yours, and I only got to shoot twice. You roll 2 dice and the scatter die, and you subtract your ballistic skill from the 2 dice if you don't roll a hit. and that's how far you deviate. So as a Space Marine, on average, you're, even if you miss, you're deviating not a great deal, and you fire it into the center of mass of a unit, and it's going to hit somebody. And any partial counts as a full hit now. There's no four plus on a partial. So
I don't get it, Craig, because I haven't seen the book. So okay. I'm a Marine, and I have a demolished cannon. What happens?
If you're well, aiming
don't
at
use
it,
a demolisher. Use a missile launcher.
Or let's use a plasma cannon.
Okay, there you go.
Let's say I had a plasma cannon on a roof, and okay. Let's say that I'm firing at the IG command squad in the crater because they're a humongous pain in my Space Marine butt.
They're also really grouped tightly together.
And they're grouped tightly together. Okay, I don't roll to hit. Do because it's a plasma cannon, so maybe that's. We'll do that later. Okay, instead of rolling to hit, I roll a scatter die and 2d6. If I don't roll a hit, I look at those two other dice. I take that number, subtract my ballistic skill, which is a 4 for a Space Marine. So let's say I rolled a 7. I subtract that, so now it's going to deviate 3 inches.
Right, and you pick the model, too.
Oh.
It's like War Machine. Think of it that way. So you pick the model, you put a template over it. If a hit comes up on the scatter die, it doesn't move. If a hit does not come up on the scatter die, it deviates 2d6 minus the ballistic skill of the firer.
Cool.
Okay, which is great, except for the plasma cannon doesn't have a hit roll anymore, right? So first turn, we were like, yay, and Russ, I blame this on Russ. Russ said, plasma cannons can't overheat anymore. And I got all excited and moved on with my turn, having killed one guy. And then Josh, a local guy, who's also been reading the book for
like 6 days straight,
came up to the table and went, actually, guys, you have to roll anyway. This was after turn two. I rolled and I hit, 8 guardsmen?
Right, he hits a beautiful shot.
It was a dream shot on this little armored fist squad. And then here in comes Josh. Actually, guys, you've got to roll. And I was like, okay, fine. I'm not going to argue. I'm going to roll. Oh, I rolled a 1. And then Russ is like, well, at least you killed the guys. And then Josh again says, actually, if you roll a 1, the shot doesn't go off. And I'm like, okay, fine. And then I'll just roll my armor save. And I rolled another 1.
It was great. From the guard side of the table, it was really funny.
It was an emotional roller coaster, but I like the rules. I just would have liked to know them ahead of time, which is my fault because I didn't read that part.
Yeah, so there's no hit roll with blast weapons, except the plasma cannon's got to make the overheat check. Yeah, basically the deal.
So when you say no to hit roll, you mean you're still rolling the die six versus your ballistic skill when shooting plasma weapons?
No, you're not. When you like with a normal in fourth edition, when you fired a missile launcher and you had it set to frag missile, you'd roll to hit, and if you missed, no template was placed. It just missed.
Right.
Okay. In fifth edition. You simply don't roll to hit. You put the template where you want it, and you roll the scatter die and the 2d6, right. And you extract your ballistic skill.
But when do you roll this one roll?
Only if it's a plasma cannon.
A weapon that's susceptible to overheating.
Right.
So you just roll a die 6, and if it comes up a 1, it overheats.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Gotcha.
So that's that wackiness. And that works the same for whether it's a ordnance weapon as well.
Yeah.
And the ordnance barrage is similar, except you don't subtract the ballistic skill when you're firing indirectly, right? It just is like the normal old way.
Yeah.
Why did you pick a distinction when I said be a demolisher, and now I'm thinking that tanks work differently or something?
Well, it's just that ordnance always, didn't always scatter, but ordnance used to not roll to hit, right? It just rolled to scatter anyway. Right.
Oh, okay, because so, it was ordnance. Okay.
Yeah, ordnance isn't a big change.
This is a change.
The ordnance actually gets a little more accurate now because of the minus of the ballista skill, right?
Okay.
So, ordnance is a little bit better. Am I right about that, John? I think I'm right about that.
That it's more accurate?
Yeah.
Well, it has a greater potential for scatter in that you can scatter more, but yeah, I mean, on average.
Because it was 1d6, right?
Yeah. So yeah, I don't know. Right. It's kind of a wash in many ways.
Yeah.
Ultimately, I'd say it's a little more inaccurate, but the fact that any partial is a hit it makes up for that a bit.
And it's awesome in low ballistic skill people's hands against horde armies because you basically just fire it into the middle, you know, and you're going to hit something, basically. You know, for orcs and guard, if they have any orcs don't have any blast weapons, very many blast weapons. But, and one more thing we should talk about is, real quickly, and then we'll get on to our next segment, allocating wounds. This works pretty straightforwardly. So you roll your wound rolls, and it's mixed. There's the mixed toughness rule, right? That's pretty much the same, except I think if they are, so in other words, it goes to the majority of the toughness in the squad you're shooting at. However, if there's more of one, you know, if there's an equal number, the new change in fifth is that you use the higher toughness.
As opposed to the lowest.
I think it used to be the lower, which is kind of nice. And then the person allocates wounds to anybody in the unit.
Before making saves.
And he has to allocate to every model once before he goes again. And then he rolls saves, and the saves are this interesting grouping thing, which I think solves a lot of issues, in my opinion, which is that you group models that are equipped identically. So if you get 4 wounds, or if you get 10 wounds on a squad, and the squad's got, you know, a Meltagun in it, a heavy weapon in it, and a veteran sergeant in it, the guys that are armed with bolters, they'd all roll their saves together, so 4 of them are wounded or whatever, and then the other guys roll each wound individually.
So you can't save your Laz Cannon or your veteran sergeant till the very end of the battle anymore.
No, you allocate to them, but
right.
You can
limit the danger they're in, but there's always a chance if you do enough wounds that they're going to fail.
What's nice about that mechanic is the same mechanic solves the problem with, you know, if you got multi-wound models mixed in with regular guys, or if you got a commissar in with a regular unit, because all you do is just allocate. If he's differently equipped, he's a different group when you roll the wounding rolls. Does that make sense? I mean, how do you think about that, John? Do you think that's an improvement? Or?
I think it's a huge improvement, and it's caused a lot of people to get very concerned because it's a pretty big change. But, you know, a lot of people on the Internet are people that, you know, read the rule book and I think understand it. But even so, you know, the 4th edition rules had, you know, mixed armor rules, which were pretty complex.
Yes.
A lot of people, even veteran gamers, don't understand how the mixed armor rules, because in some cases they're hard to understand. And also there was another thing called a Torrent of Fire, which is a made-up name, but basically it was, you know, a way to represent the, you know, veteran sergeant or the Power Fist guy could be killed earlier in the game. And both of those rules were there to basically do what this simplified rule does.
Yeah.
But even though this is an easier rule to understand, it has some little wonky aspects to it that allows what seems like abuse in some people's eyes, because it allows you to place, you know, if you have more wounds than you have models in the unit, you're able to place those extra wounds where you want, essentially. So you can dump all the really nasty wounds on a one guy. So say you have, like, 5 guys in the squad, and there's 2 plasma gun wounds, and then, you know, 7 bolter shots or something,
right.
You're able to, you know, dump both plasma gun shots on a single guy, thereby, you know, reducing the amount of damage you might have. And so in very extreme situations of units with really high armor saves and really low model counts, so like, you know, 3 models, and you're shooting at them with, like, you know, 3 plasma guns and a bunch of bolter shots, you're actually, you know, can end up doing less damage than if you just fire the plasma guns, because the player, and this is very clearly said in the rule book, so it's not like it's a loophole.
Right.
They know it's there, they just decided it's okay.
Right.
But, you know, in those situations, there are some situations where you can dump, you know, all the plasma guns on a single guy.
Right.
But interesting.
Yeah, but that's pretty, and that's okay. But I think the gain is worth the loss there.
It's a price to pay for simplicity, and I
right.
think that you can't overstate that enough. It's like, you know, people say, well, it worked just fine as it is, but it's not.
No, it doesn't.
You sit someone down, you try to explain the mixed, you know, the mixed armor rule and the torrent of fire rule, and they start scratching their head, or they forget about the rules, and they just don't use them. They're like, huh?
Well, I've gotten into huge arguments with some of my best friends over things like, you got an attack bike mixed with 2 regular bikes, and how do you allocate wounds? And not, you know, it's just like, just
right.
really simple. Seems like a trivial situation, but there's just moments where the wounding goes the wrong way. And this just makes it totally simple. It does introduce some weird abstractions occasionally, but there's no debate about how it's supposed to be done. That's what I like.
Exactly, which is great.
Yep. Right, I agree.
Yeah, that sounds great. Again, because you might not agree with it, but it's hard to argue if like John just mentioned, it's pretty clear they know it, so it's hard to argue it. Like, well, that's what they decided for simplicity's sake.
Right.
So it makes for less rules debates, doesn't it?
Yep.
Yeah, I like that. That sounds great.
And one last note about shooting that I have here is about buildings. And I don't, people are like, who cares about buildings? But this is a big deal because the way we used to have some of the tables at Dakka and some of the more common terrain pieces that are available from Games Workshop.
Especially City Fight.
It's in City Fight, where you have these broken half buildings with multiple levels of, you know, little platforms in there you can stand on. And you get these weird mechanics in 4th edition where you'd fire a missile launcher in there, and it would land on the bottom level. So does that mean everybody under the temple gets hit on all levels? Or if you're shooting the top and the scatters, what happens? They totally resolve that. Very clear examples in the book. Basically, when you're shooting, you got to pick the level you're firing at. And if it scatters, it only hits guys on that level. So if it scatters off the building and it's at level 2, then nobody gets hit. And even covers how
basically
framers
the cities of death rules for the most part.
Right. And they brought it right into the edition, which is nice, which is very nice.
Yeah, compared to the, you know, the last edition, which had absolutely no rules for buildings. It was like, you want buildings, make up your own rules.
Right, right.
right. Vast improvement. I mean, there's a big section. I'd say it's about 5 or 6 pages. Yeah. It covers both enclosed buildings and ruins completely. And so, you know, I'd say it's much, much better in that department.
Awesome pictures. So any other comments on shooting?
No, nope. I liked it.
Nope.
Well, we're going to take a... Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to delve into hand-to-hand combat.
I'm Rafe, Hollywood Granger, and this is the Hollywood Minute. I was recently asked, what exactly is a role-playing game? Well, I've given it some thought, and this is my answer. It's to play by immersing oneself into a story that is created and driven only by the bounds of one's imagination. Written and directed by the DM or Dungeon Master, whose role it is to spin the tale, to put out the puzzles to be solved, and to create great battles to be talked about later in life. The role of the character is to lose oneself for even just a little bit in just a little way. To be that dwarven warrior smiting the enemies of the arch nemesis of your game. The rules are really just there to make it a game versus just a storytelling. It gives the DM and the characters boundaries, fixed guidelines, and a means to win or lose, succeed or fail, to live or die. As I approach my own 4.0, I do wax nostalgic for those times in my younger life, creating campaigns, rolling up characters, and sitting around a pool table with my closest grade school friends fighting kobolds. If I really squint hard, I can still see my friends, for they were a human monk, a gnome illusionist, a dwarf fighter, a human druid, and a halfling thief. And beside our character sheets and number 2 pencils and our 20-sided die, we had homemade cookies, a bowl of Doritos, we only had one type of Doritos back then, a bowl of cheese curls, and an endless supply of red Kool-Aid in large Dixie cups. Ah, those were the days. Well, that's my story. Good night.
All right, welcome back. Well, we're continuing our 40K
extravaganza.
Detailed extravaganza review. And we're on to hand-to-hand combat. So, John, why don't you take us off this segment here? How do you, you move in on the assault phase here and what are the changes in that part of the show there?
Well, we talked previously, now you can run, so all your close combat units are going to get into combat probably a little bit earlier, including, you know, your big old hand-to-hand carnifexes, which you would never see on the table before. Now you can maybe bring those to the table, or your Khorne Berserkers, for example.
Yeah, an excellent example.
Anything that doesn't shoot before that would just get shot up, now you have an actual chance to get into combat. But what happens is, the big change is they've changed the rules to try to make close combat be resolved in a single round of combat. And how they did that is when you get into combat now, the opposing side immediately moves any models that aren't in base-to-base combat 6 inches forward to clump everyone together.
Yep.
So it's kind of like the old countercharge rule, but now everyone has it. And now people who have the countercharge ability, they get their attack bonus if they pass a leadership test. So they, you know, test to see if they pass their coolness, so to speak. And then if they do, they get a +1 attack when they countercharge. But everyone else just sort of clumps in. So basically your combat is much more condensed right off the bat. And everyone fights who is, you know, in base contact or within 2 inches of that combat, basically. If you're engaged at the start of that fighting, you are going to get the fight, regardless of if the model was killed. So it's not like 4th edition where you check at each individual, you know, initiative step to see if your model is still engaged. You just see who's in at the start of the round, and then you start working down the initiative steps. And the other big change is you can pull casualties from anywhere in the unit. So basically if, you know, the front of your orc unit smashes into the guard unit, and you still have a bunch of guys out in the back, you know, let's say the orcs get smashed into and the orcs are fighting last with their low initiative, well, you get to pull the guys out from the back of your unit to make sure those dudes in the front still get to swing at their full
including
potential.
Your knob with the power fist.
Including right. Your knob with the power fist. So basically, you know, most of the models in your units are going to get to fight because of right. the new clumping and because yeah. of the way the yeah. casualty removal, most of the people are going to get to swing. Now, another huge change is the combat resolution. It doesn't matter about how many models are in the combat or anything like that. It's just how many wounds did you cause compared to the other side? How many wounds did they cause? And you just total that up, and whatever that difference is the negative modifier to the leadership test for the losing side to run away. So right. if you smash the other side, you know, kill 8 more guys than they do, they're testing at -8 on their leadership, which is basically guaranteed to break and run away.
Right.
And just like in last edition, you can run them down, you know, based off of your initiative characteristics, you can run them down and just wipe those units out. If they run away, so breaking a side is a very potent ability. And if the side is fearless, if it doesn't run away, whatever that negative modifier is, they take that many extra wounds. So if you beat them by 8 wounds, but they're fearless, well, now they're taking 8 wounds. So yeah. it is a really, really punishing single round of combat. And then the final key to that puzzle, which I know that Rafe would be pleased with, is you can no longer consolidate into another unit. So no matter how potent your hand-to-hand combat unit is, you're not going to be, like, ticky-tacking, engaging another unit to stop from being shot in the next phase. You are most likely going to resolve that combat, and you're going to be left sitting there for the rest of the opposing army to shoot you to death. And what that means is you need to come in with, you know, 2 or 3 assault units and engage, you know, a whole flank of the opponent and wipe out or tie up as many of those units as possible, because otherwise you're just going to get gunned down.
And we saw that. It was awesome. We saw it in the test games where a unit of demons would come in on the unit of guard. And, you know, when your guard's deployed, your units are close because you've got so many guys. So you got a unit of guard. 2 inches away is your command squad with the power fist guys and the sergeant and everything. And then you got another squad right next to there. And, you know, in 4th edition, they'd come in. They'd fight the first guys. They might not kill them all because they just touch one guy. And then they, you know, they fall back. And then the unit persists, combat persists, so I can't kill them.
And they're blocking twice their height, and you can't shoot anything over them, and that whole side of the board's locked up.
Yeah, and then they move, and what happens is he comes in, my unit counter-assaults his unit, everybody fights, the 10 guardsmen, the 6 demons. Of course, the demons wipe the guardsmen out. I kill one, maybe, if I'm lucky. But then they're standing there, literally 2 inches away from my command squad with 2 power fists, and they can't do a darn thing. They consolidate D6 inches, and then my squad comes up and says, let's fight. They charge in, and he hits, you know, a couple times, but I can pick who dies, so I don't kill the power fist yep. dudes. And then I go and I actually whack a few demons, and they kind of suck kills them.
Yeah. Well, I actually, because they're fearless, they ended up having to take extra wounds, yep. and I had one guy left.
And so it worked out pretty well. So I actually got the feeling of my guard. And then the other time it happened, I was able to shoot the other yep. units with yep. my guns. So you feel it's funny because I had the tension as they got closer to me. I had that normal tension a guard player has. Yep. Oh, great. That one combat unit's going to get to me, and a whole army's going to fall, but it didn't. He killed one unit, and then the entire card army shot at him and just blew him out.
And in practice, a hand-to-hand army is not the mindless missile that it used to be. You've got to be really right. careful and selective of which combats you want to fight and what units you want to bring up, because the counter charge and the shooting, the wave of shooting you're going to face if you wipe out a unit, is huge.
And the other thing that happens in practice is that the speed bump now works. So in other words, if I throw a unit forward to try to slow your advance, that actually works because now you will not get any extra movement except for the small sweep. But if I see you coming at me on 2 flanks and down the middle, if I can stall 2 of your units and have one come at me piecemeal, I'm going to lose one unit, but I'm going to be able to blow that unit away. So there's a lot more strategies for the shooting army to soak an assault. Yeah, I'm going to lose a unit, but hopefully I can counteract that and take you out. So I feel like from the shooting side, I have a lot more strategies. Not to mention
so
the
I
fact...
Guess-
Go ahead.
I have to ask a couple questions. So when you, this is to either John, Craig, or Russ. So when you throw the speed bump gets wiped out, and I heard there's a D6 consolidation move. They can't consolidate into a new hand-to-hand combat?
No, cannot.
In fact, write the rules, they must stay an inch away from all enemy models, including the unit that just ran away. So if you win a combat and that unit you're just fighting runs away and you don't catch them in the sweeping advance rule, even if they only run 2 inches away, you cannot move touching them. You cannot enter an inch of anybody.
So, Russ, you have the option when you said your command squad with the two power fists is sitting there, you actually can shoot your entire army at them first.
Oh, yeah, and I did.
Yep.
I shot the crap out of them, then I sent in the command squad, right? You bet.
That's
and the
cool.
command squad fired its assault weapon. It's a melted gun, too, before it went in.
Look, which sounds harsh, but there were two turns where his entire army fired at a grand total of four models.
Yeah, well, because it's guard, right? So you got the four chaos bikers, all toughness five, three plus saves, they, you know... The leader's in there, and you fire everything because you're praying to kill the darn standard so another demon doesn't show up. And you fire everything, and you kill them, but you finally get to see the last gun's rapid fire because they didn't, on the old rules, they would have killed that first unit, or they would have been the classic example of the orc charge, right, where your orcs get there with one model and nobody scrums in, so I can only kill one of the, you know, the threat zone is only 2 inches, so I only kill one guy, and so my guard, it's guaranteed the combat's going to go into my turn. Now the combat's there. Under the old rules, a blocked line of sight doesn't do that anymore. It's true line of sight now, so that's not a problem anymore. And go ahead.
So it sounds like they fixed, because I think Craig, and if I'm putting words in your mouth, let me know, Craig, but I think Craig and I are cinematic gamers, so all I really wanted, I didn't want my Imperial Guard to turn to morph into Marines. I just wanted to have that vision of being the Gaunt's ghosts fighting the Sons of Sect.
This was totally Starship Troopers the movie.
Yeah, you really felt
I mean, it was just like this wave of guardsmen kind of walking backwards going, holy crap! Right. And
you can run too, so your guardsmen go, oh crap, and really haul butt, and you need to get out of there.
The counter charge rule really helps with that too, because you get the feeling like your guys are like, here they come, let's go, and they go charging out. And also,
what's the counter charge rule?
Well, remember, when you get contacted by a charging unit, you move all your models that aren't engaged.
Right.
It's like Space Wolves to go in, so
your guys react to the charge in a way.
You don't feel static. I get to fight back usually, and she can all of me.
Every phase feels more interactive between the two players.
And the other subtle thing that counter charge move does is like Russ was saying, if you only got like one orc in the hand hand combat against the guard, you're fighting just this tiny little thing, and then eventually when that combat is drawn, you know, the orcs come and they pile in, and now your whole area is condensed with all this models and crap. Now if one model gets into combat with your guardsmen go counter charging out from your lines a little bit, and so in a way it kind of bring space, a little more space into the game.
Right.
Okay.
And the orcs are almost guaranteed to kill those guardsmen.
Right.
And the orcs consolidate. Now the orc mob is standing there in front of an entire army of guard going, okay, let's do this.
So that's the one question I wanted to ask you. Is there a way, just by funky dice rolls or fearless, what if the orcs come in, they hit the Imperial Guard, counter charge, but they leave one model? Or is that not going to happen? There's no way for that model.
It can happen.
It's very unlikely, though.
Right, because of the negative leadership modifier.
Because of the negative leadership modifier. If the orcs come in and they kill 9 guardsmen, and the guardsmen killed no orcs, that one guardsman is testing on leadership -9.
But, which is an automatic, almost automatic.
Snake Eyes still,
But it, theoretically, right, something could happen where, let's say it's a sentinel or something, and the orcs just roll bad, and the combat could persist, right?
So we had it happen a couple times, but the persisting combats were more dramatic because they were more rare.
And it's not a huge problem, because usually they still don't block line of sight anymore, because the problem that Rafe and I have talked about in the past on the show is, you know, you get the combat touching with the one gene stealer. The gene stealer squad is 30 wide, and technically under 4th edition rules, that entire gene stealer squad now blocks line of sight, and your whole army's screened.
Can I point something out now? Yeah. That mysteriously, Rafe all of a sudden now knows what a gene stealer is again?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't say gene stealer.
No. It was Termagant that you couldn't remember. But
no, I didn't say it. I said Imperial Guard versus orcs.
No.
But in any case, that problem is solved, too, so... So a few of my peeves that I've been vocal about that are fixed is it's very unlikely for combat to be persistent, which was a huge problem I had with 40K.
Yeah.
Hand-to-hand combat does not block line of sight. Combat looks awesome. It's fast. It's bloody. Things just die and it's done. And the counter rule, for the assaulter, now it sounds very negative assaulting, what we just described here, right? It's all in favor of the shooting army, but there's one big thing that I used to hate with my orcs that I would love now. And that is your orc mob charges. And who gets to the front line? Your knob with the power fist and like one other orc. Now the Marines, probably standing there with a librarian or someone with high initiative, swings first. And he can only kill two guys. And who does he kill? He gets 3 wounds and he kills the one orc and he kills the knob. So now the super powerful shalting army of orcs doing exactly what they're supposed to be doing barely gets there. The two guys who can do anything die. Now it scrums in, and the orcs have lost their wog, they've lost their, and now it's just going to be a long, drawn-out battle between five space marines killing off 30 orcs over the course of three turns. That's not what happens anymore. Now what happens is, my guys barely get there, right? But the marines countercharge, so now they're all touching another orc. Everybody within 2 inches gets the swing. The other thing is, because I can wound anybody, if I really will roll really well with my orcs, I can wound marines that are out of the 2-inch thing. So I'm going to get like my 20 or 30 chop attacks off more likely than not. And even if he does manage to only be able to kill two or three models, I can pick orcs off the back and not lose that knob. So again, there's a real nice thing for assault armies here too. You just got to rethink your strategies. But the idea of just getting there and fighting works now. It's much more like fantasy. Once the two units touch, it's going to be a battle and everybody's going to be involved and it's just going to be a big old scrum.
But the wound allocation, again, remember, is just like in shooting. So that's a smaller assaulting squad has a greater chance that its more powerful, more important models are going to get killed early.
Yeah, and that really comes into play with rending. Because you can take, you know, in combat you tend to get a lot of wounds compared to shooting. You get a lot more wounds, and it's possible to dump all of the rending wounds onto, in some cases, onto one or two models, and thereby sort of nerf down rending attacks quite a bit in hand-to-hand combat.
Yeah, and also we should mention rending was nerfed a little more because rending now has to be on the wound roll for the six, right, not the to-hit roll.
Right.
So that's a big change also. And also, I can't remember if it's a change or not, John, but in 5th edition, a rending weapon when it strikes a vehicle is now plus D3. Was it always that?
No.
Nope, it was D6 before.
So yeah, so they're also a little weaker against vehicles too, which is probably not a bad thing. It makes maybe it leaves tougher to choice between the assault cannon and cyclo missile.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so now let's talk about any of the comments on assaults, because that was some big changes in there. Hope we got all our...
Nope, I think we got it all.
Yeah. All right, let's talk about vehicles. So... Craig, you want to take the vehicle summary?
Sure. Well, on the forums, the general consensus seems to be that vehicles are weaker.
That seems to be the case.
And I facing the guard army twice, I would disagree.
I took, just so to be clear, in my guard army, 1,500 points, I had a Lehman Russ battle tank, a Lehman Russ demolisher kitted out with the plasma las cannon combo. I had a Hellhound, which is very exciting in 5th edition because of the large amounts of cover saves, which the Hellhound gets to conveniently ignore.
Yeah.
And I had two Chimeras.
Yep. Or Chimeras, for those of us with a classical education.
Right. I don't have one of those.
And no, you do not.
This is what I get for being on a show with two English features.
Tucky. Anyway, so yeah. So
and how many tanks died in our second game?
In our second game?
Yeah.
Our second game.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm having a hard time remembering
I think
that
would be zero.
How many tanks died in the first game?
Well...
In the first game?
Well, a
How
lot.
How many tanks died in the first game?
Okay.
All of them, I believe. No, so if we average it out, 50% of your...
I think the hell I live.
I'm going to spray water on you, too.
Sorry, go ahead. Okay.
I'm looking at the wrong thing. Okay. Movement changes first with the vehicles. They did change, again, what can shoot. You can move six and fire one weapon as usual, but they lowered the strength of what they call a defensive weapon now. Right. So that basically my two Lehman Russ tanks that I own that have three heavy bolters and a heavy Stubba are now butt useless. Well, they're not butt useless at all, but they're not going to be trundling.
That's what I'm saying on the forum. I think that's the source of the biggest complaints.
Right. But they're not going to be trundling around. What?
I'm a little lost. Why are they butt useless?
Okay.
And what
I used to be able to do was move. Both of those tanks are kitted out exactly the same way: three heavy bolters and a heavy Stubba with a dozer blade. So what I would do is I would deploy behind trees, which doesn't have the same
which no longer block line of sight for
which
these
doesn't have the same salutary effect anymore. And then I would move into the trees and fire all three heavy bolters and the heavy Stubba at any infantry unit of my choice and watch much of it evaporate.
Because
you could fire all of the weapons that were strength six.
Five, I think it was.
Six, I believe.
Strength six and under. Right. Now you have to, because those were all classified as defensive weapons.
So the basic rule is you can fire one weapon plus all your defensive weapons, even if you move under fourth edition, under both editions.
And that didn't change, but what changed was the definition of a defensive weapon went from strength six to strength four.
Right.
Oh.
So now you could fire one heavy bolter and the heavy Stubba.
Strength four.
Because it's strength four.
Right. or you could fire your multi-laser and your pintle-mounted heavy stubba.
Right.
But what you can't do, which we used to be able to do, is roll your Chimera forward, fire the multi-laser, the stubba, and the heavy bolter on the hull. Or on the Lehman Russ, was it, what's it called? Dakka? We could call the Dakka Russ.
The Annihilator?
The Annihilator, right. Yeah. Which has all three heavy bolters on it and whatnot.
And the auto cannons.
Right.
Yeah.
So the general thinking is...
Or a Predator with the auto cannon and two heavy bolters.
So when you see this rule out of context, you think, oh, well, vehicles now, they're never going to move, it's all going to be static. But
the key is, they don't have to move as much anymore because they're shooting right through those area terrain pieces.
Yeah, when you take it in total,
yeah.
When you take it in total, there's not as many places to hide, which is the big thing. And also... I think vehicles had to be toned down because vehicles now are much more survivable.
Oh yes.
Let's talk about that.
They got away from three different penetration tables. So instead of having ordnance, full pen, and glancing table, you now have one table that has modifiers dependent upon whether you glanced. It's a -2. If it's an AP dash, it's a -1. If the weapon's AP dash for like sniper rifles, and if it's an AP one, it's +1. And then is there an ordnance also?
No, nope. Ordnance gets 2d6, pick the highest.
Okay.
No. Yep.
And that's it. So there's one chart, and that's all you're worrying about. And all you have to do is remember what the modifiers are, which is pretty basic, and you're good to go. And I don't know if we were rolling low last night or if it's the way the rules were built, and it felt really cool. I was literally picking apart those freaking tanks.
Well, here's the big change. The big change is that to kill a vehicle, you need to roll a 5 or a 6, okay? But a glance is a -2, right?
Right.
So on a glancing hit, unless it's a melta weapon or an open-top vehicle, you cannot destroy a vehicle.
Right.
And that is huge.
Yep, right? That's very huge. And on top of that, vehicles get cover saves.
That's the other big thing.
So a 4+ save and boom, doesn't matter that I rolled a full pen and a 6.
Right. It's a little harder for a vehicle. It's got to be physically half obscured. Going through cover doesn't cut it. It's got to be physically 50% blocked.
Yeah.
But that's not that hard to pull off because you can hide behind other vehicles. You can hide behind some of the trees. But if you get 50% of your vehicle essentially hull down, right, it's not just it counts as glancing like it used to be. It's I roll a 4. If I roll a 4 or better, I ignore your hit. And that's after you roll your pen rolls. So you roll a hit, you roll your pen, you get one full pen, I roll a 4+, oh, I ignore it, nothing happens to me.
Mm-hmm.
And that is just, we discovered, huge. Yeah,
it was huge. And
as Craig mentioned, in the first game, all my vehicles were pretty much destroyed, but not one of them, I believe, died from a shooting attack that wasn't a melta weapon or a melta bomb.
Yeah, there was
They had to get in tight on me. The plasma cannons were bouncing off, the missile launchers were bouncing off.
The las cannons were bouncing off. Well, they weren't bouncing off. I was rolling pretty low.
My cover saves. You get that one last cannon that, whatever.
What you can't do is I have your Space Marines with one las cannon sitting in the backfield picking off a tank a turn.
Right, because it doesn't work.
I like it.
It was.
You know what that sounds like? Sounds like the regeneration roll on your monsters in fantasy.
I guess so. Okay.
Okay, we'll allow it.
Whatever that means. Good. Now, a couple things they got cleared up here, and maybe, John, you can chime in on this, too, some of the clarity I think I found in here. A couple more things we should mention. Because it's true line of sight, this has been asking about this, skimmers do block what they block. So it is no more ignore skimmers for line of sight or any of that stuff. If you can see under them, you can shoot it, whatever, there's the skimmer. And there's, I think, John, also, to help with this true line of sight thing, don't the rules pretty clear that you have to have your vehicle on its right-sized base at its right height?
Yeah, they changed the rule. In 4th edition, it was you could, put it on its base or larger. And now they just say it needs to be on the base it comes with.
Right.
But if you want to, make a scenic base, you have to check with your opponent ahead of time.
Right.
And, some people don't like that. You say, well, that's your opponent permission, blah, blah, blah. But, come on. You always have your opponent permission. And ultimately, if they don't like the way that it is, you're not going to rip it off its base as you're playing. You're just going to have to treat it as if it's on a smaller base, and you're both going to have to work around that at that point.
It really removes the whole concept of modeling for advantage, which I don't.
We've never seen that.
There's still a huge amount of that in
the
rules,
you can still have the crawling hive tyrant, right, and all that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. But one thing I want to go back to about the bases is just the skimmer bases. They never really discussed those before in the rules at all.
Yeah.
And now... much, much, much more clear. It basically says, you know, you have to be on your skimmer base for your skimmers, and then when it's destroyed, you know, take the skimmer off its base or immobilized, and that's the only time you can take it off its base. You can't take it off willy-nilly during the game to change the height of the skimmer. And this is the one that I kind of really like, is that if you've glued your skimmer base into place and it gets destroyed, then the wreck becomes a floating wreck.
I like
basically
that.
The vehicle's destroyed, but its anti-grav motors are still powered, so you have this floating wreck floating
that's
through the
awesome.
Sky. And I really, really like that visual idea.
That's good. And to back up your point, too, they are very clear about how wrecks work. I know in previous editions it was like, well, you can leave them on, you can take them off. Now they're supposed to stay on unless you got the vehicle exploding result, right?
Right.
And they are very clear rules on what they count as, you know, difficult terrain.
Dangerous.
Dangerous,
right.
All that stuff.
That's cool.
And one other thing they cleared up, I think, a little bit is there's a situation where your tank, you know, the facing you're supposed to be shooting of a tank is totally blocked by terrain for some reason. So then you can shoot the side of the vehicle instead. And then you get these situations where, well, he's supposed to be shooting in the front arc because that's where the shooter really is, but he can't see the front armor's behind a rock, but he can see the back edge of the Chimera. So since I'm shooting you in the side, I want your side armor 10. And then the other player would be like, well, but you're in my front arc, and the rules say for my front arc, blah, blah, blah. Well, that argument's totally nerfed, because now there's actually an example and a ruling for this in the book, which says if that case happens, and there's a nice little picture, the vehicle gets a 3-plus cover save. But, yes, you get the side armor. So you get the side armor, but I get a 3-plus cover save, and that seems like a totally fair solution to me, because, you know, what are you going to do?
Yep, sounds good.
And one of the vehicle mechanic, oh, we should also mention, I think people asked this in the forum, you can still fire ordnance on the move. That didn't change.
It's actually better because there's no negative penalty for moving
firing
ordnance.
That's right. You might as well move and shoot your ordnance. So there's one example of, actually, tanks are not less mobile if you've got a battle cannon on them, because you're going to probably be firing the battle cannon, which is your only weapon anyway. You can't fire anything else if you fire a battle cannon still. That's still the rule. You might as well move six. So
and it sounds like what John mentioned Phil Kelly was saying is movement's half the fun. So now the tanks are moving and shooting ordnance. How cool is that?
They are.
It is cool, but you know the whole vehicle rules are a little strange coming from that comment that he made, in my opinion, because you have everything else in the game that got more mobile, and the vehicles, although they didn't get less mobile, well, actually a little bit, but they basically can't shoot and move as much. So in a way, they got kind of less mobile.
But
so
you know
it's
what
I
found happens is... they get more mobile near the end of the game, and here's why. We should mention this. The damaging table is very clear about what happens if you get multiple of the same results, right? So as you get multiple weapon destroyed results, or multiple immobilized it, or reduces weapons, things like that, right? But as you start to lose, because of the minus two, and glancings tend to seem to destroy weapons all the time. Like, it seemed like every time Craig got a pen or a glance, it was always breaking a weapon. And what that ends up happening is, at some point, you start to running low on weapons, and they're like, well, screw it, I'll just move. And I found my Chimeras, you know, as soon as they lost the multi-laser, it was move and fire the heavy bolter and the stubba every time, right? Why not?
Sure.
And the other thing that happens to you, and we'll get to this in the mission, and this goes back to that point of the rules and total thing, is because vehicles are so survivable, people may have heard vehicles can't be scoring units, but any unit, including vehicles, can contest a scoring position. And what ends up happening is near the end game, your vehicles, because it's just are left. And you're like, ooh, I'm just gonna, you know, actually against Craig, I was like, I'm going to tank shock through
in
and just
fact,
contest that objective.
That made a win for me into a tie.
Yes, the Demolisher Siege Tank did that. And one other thing we should mention about vehicles, or two more things we should mention about vehicles. One is hand-to-hand combat against vehicles always strikes the rear armor.
Yeah, which I thought was an awesome and very cinematic change.
Unless you're a walker, in which case it's always the front. But that's neat, and it makes Land Raiders and Demolishers all the better, because they have better back armor, especially the Land Raider. And also, the big new rule, which is really out of left field, is ramming, right? And
tell me about it.
Well, ramming is something that every orc player's dream, and it was sort of fuzzily handled by some orc war gear. But now, vehicles, and this is in the tank shock section, so only tanks, unless you have special war gear, can ram. And what they do is you drive your vehicle into another vehicle, and you get the strength of the hit is based on how far your vehicle moved. Every full 3 inches is plus one to the strength. And the front armor of your vehicle. So every point above 10 is plus one to the strength. So if I have a Lehman Russ battle tank and I'm ramming something, and I've moved 10 inches, that's three full sets of 3 inches, that's plus three. And my front armor is 14, that's 4/10. That's 4+3 is strength 7. You also get a plus one if you're actually a tank, which makes it an 8.
Now, why would there be a plus one if you're actually a tank if only tanks can do
Great
it?
Great question. Well, the reason is because...
That wasn't a planted question. I'm very
you
curious.
You also get the same hit back. So if I'm ramming a... orc truck...
Gotcha.
Right? Your truck is not a tank. So I'm hitting him at strength 8. He hits me back with everything I hit him with. So in other words, he gets all my speed against me, so he gets plus 3 for that. His armor's only a 10, so he gets no bonus for that. And he's not a tank, so he gets no bonus for that.
Uh-huh.
So there you go. But also I think that comes into play because some vehicles, some races, i.e. the orcs, have weapons that allow their vehicles to ram even though they're not a tank.
Uh-huh.
So I think an orc truck with a ram, unless the warrior says he does count as a tank, does not. But I think the new orc codex is written with 5th in mind because it actually says adds plus 2 to their front armor for purposes of ramming, which now makes sense because it adds their front armor like 12 for ramming.
Yep.
So you're not going to kill a Lumerous battle tank with an orc truck, but you might get a Chimera on the side.
Yeah, yeah.
So what do you think about ramming, John? What do you think that's going to do to the game?
I think it's a fun change. It's not one that I mean, I remember ramming back from the days of 2nd edition, and I don't know. I would say that it wasn't needed, but I'm not horribly against it. I have to say that I didn't remember seeing that it was for tanks only, but I honestly didn't give it that hard a look. So.
It is because it appears in the tank shock section, and the way it's set up, maybe debatable, but the way I've read it, and the reason I think that's important is that one of the big fears on the internet, right, is that someone can take a cheap Viper and start flying it into things. But because it's a tank shock thing, I don't believe.
I didn't see that section, so I would not endorse this as 100%.
I'm pretty confident because I read it 3 times. It says, like, it's a 2-page fail, and the topic for the 2 pages is a tank shock. And then it says what you can do. And
Right, but if that's all you're going by, then I think that's probably the first really vague thing you've seen.
It could be vague.
Well, we'll just hold off judgment for now and go back and check the rules.
I think if it is tanks only, it's pretty
strange. One thing I do want to add in that there's a rule in there that I thought was pretty fun when it comes to ramming is if you're a walker and you get rammed, you have a choice of skimmers have a chance to evade the ram by rolling a 3+, which is pretty cool.
That's cool.
You can ram skimmers, is kind of neat.
Yeah.
And walkers, they can either attempt a death or glory attack like any other infantry model where they get one attack to destroy the vehicle or stop it. But if they fail at that, they get hit on their rear armor to show that they're not braced for impact.
Oh, that's cool.
As an alternative, they can just brace for impact and not go for the death or glory attack, and then they get hit on whatever armor facing facing the vehicle. And they can only do a death or glory attack if they're not being hit in the back armor, by the way. Right. So,
I
really like that idea. But overall, I could have done without ramming, but I think it's a fun little thing that gives vehicles something to do when they have all their weapons blown off. But it doesn't really fall. I don't know. I mean, it has a cinematic place, you know. So I guess I'm for it.
I think it's there the same reason Tank Shock is there, and I think it's less there to be a way you can damage somebody, or that's certainly true, and it's more there to prevent the, you know, if I parked a Viper in front of your Land Raider, blocking your moving to contest an objective, that'd be frustrating. So now I can drive through you, because the rule on ramming also is if I destroy you outright, I can keep going.
Right,
So it's at least a chance to get through something, especially in a very unrealistic scenario of like a little sentinel blocking a Land Raider or things like that. So I think it gives you a little more, like Tank Shock, where you can't screen a tank with an infantry unit from moving, basically.
Well, they had that in 4th edition to a degree, in that you could Tank Shock a vehicle with lighter frontal armor out of the way.
It would
still come to situations where like a Falcon on the last turn would fly over an objective unless you had something that was, you know, higher armor waiting around there. There's no way you could back that thing off. So, you're right.
It's something. They each have a chance, right? And the mechanics are pretty clean, so we'll see.
Ray, if you had a question?
Yeah, hey, Craig, you know what else can ram that you're going to see in the future? The Gnarlhorn Satyr from the Circle of Oberos.
Oh, really?
I'm just saying.
What game is that? What's Oberos?
Oh,
you mean Ouroboros. Oh, that's that privateer. What is that, pirate? I don't know.
All right. Okay, so we've been hinting at... So I think that wraps up the vehicle section here. We've been hinting at the missions, and let's talk about how this works a little bit. Now, in the book, there are two different tables you roll on to figure out what kind of game you're going to play. There's three different scenarios you can get, which I basically mean the kinds of objectives you're going to have to try to fight for. I think there's one that's just like basically kill them all, and the other two are objectives on the table.
Yeah, we played two of the three.
We played two of the objective ones. And then there's three different kinds of deployments you can roll up. There's the classic long table edge versus long table edge.
Yep.
There's the classic quadrant mission, or the one most people remember is cleanse, yep, probably, deployment style. And then there is what they call the Dawn of War deployment, which is, well, too complicated to get into, but basically it involves the only infantry on the table and you sort of really grow up. But it's pretty neat. It's a pretty neat scenario. And in all the games, or all the scenarios in the book, they all have reserves and they all have random game length, which is sort of interesting. Random game length is the same as you remember. It's 5 turns guaranteed, and after that it gets a little more likely to end the game on dice rolls. And reserves is sort of interesting.
Is that what it always was, or wasn't it you get 6?
No, it's changed.
Oh, yeah, it used to be 6, and then you might have a...
Oh, was it 6 before?
Or was it 4?
Go ahead. What was it?
John, we defer to you.
Right.
In the last edition, it was basically you go to 6 and then you roll to see where it goes from there. Now it starts at 5, but it's a much, it's like
much
a 3 plus,
likely,
I think.
Yeah.
And it only goes to turn 7, so,
right.
So it's a much better random game length, I think.
Yeah.
Now reserves are interesting too, because, reserves, when a game has reserves, you can keep any number of models in reserve.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't, that's different, right? Because usually the scenario would say you keep this number in reserve or that number in reserve or specific troop types in reserve. Now it's just when you play this mission, player's discretion, you keep your whole army in reserve if you want, unless the mission says you must put something on the table. So 2 of the 3 missions don't require that. There's basically one of the missions, there's going to be an objective in your deployment zone and an objective in your opponent's deployment zone. Whoever controls the most is the winner.
And
the other mission is going to be D3 plus 2 or something?
I thought it was D3 plus 2, yeah.
D3 plus 2 objectives on the table anywhere, and then you do this alternating deployment. You place them all over the place to get. And again, whoever controls the most, then there's a kill them all one. So in those scenarios, having your reserves come on later could be kind of interesting. And we should point out that for those objectives, to capture those objectives, you have to be a troop choice. And when you're a troop choice, to be a scoring unit, it'd be a troop choice, and that troop choice, if it's a vehicle, does not count, or if it's a swarm, it does not count, or if it's fleeing, it does not count.
Right. But as long as it has a single unbroken model, it can claim that objective.
Now, that's really interesting, because that means you are, but in the missions, now it's interesting, the scoring things are game-wide, doesn't matter what mission you're playing, that's the scoring rules. In the missions in the book, they each state that a non-scoring unit can contest. Now, because that's in the mission, that could probably be optional in other missions. But what that basically means is you got to protect your troop choices to win, but you can use anything to contest or play for the draw.
Hmm.
Right? So if all of your troops are dead, you're not out of the game.
Nope.
But you're just playing for the check, stalemate, right, at that point. You're playing to contest everything.
Yeah.
But at least you're playing.
Right.
That, but it makes your troops feel more important, and they've got, you know, you're not, like, taking 2 5-man Laz-Plaz squads, sitting them in the backfield and plinking away while your assault squads, Terminators, and bikes, et cetera, all run forward and do the whole battle for you.
And as a guard player, it's kind of neat, because, now, granted, you know, the a lot of people are going to say, well, the Space Marines are the best basic troops in the game. This is clearly Space Marine bias. But the guards, when you have one platoon, which is one troop choice, you're scoring a minimum of 3 different units there, right? The two infantry and then the command that can go running off on their own directions and grab these things.
Yep.
And they only need one guy left. And don't forget, pretty much everywhere you go, you're going to be finding a 4-plus cover save. It's not that easy to kill off 10 guards with a 4-plus cover save. I mean, you got to kind of work at it. So it's and you can run, so your guardsmen can get there. And your Chimeras are more survivable, so you could probably get them there in a tank if you need to also. What I found was a lot of fun was, and we'll talk about this, deep striking rules are actually slightly safer. I say slightly safer because deep striking is essentially the same. Oh, and deep striking is, I think the way I read this, John, and tell me if you read it differently. Deep striking and infiltrating and scouting are always on now.
Yes.
Right? Which is awesome because
you
pay for that stuff when you buy these troops. And to have missions that don't have them is just stinky. So they're always on. You can always infiltrate. You can always scout. And you always deep strike.
Infiltrators and scouts, if you keep those units in reserve, you're able to bring them on from the short table edges.
Yeah, bonus, right. You get to bring them on. So when you bring on your scouting units from reserve, you roll a D6, and on a 1 or 2, they come from the left, 3 or 4, they come from the right, 5 or 6, your choice. Which is huge, especially in these objective missions.
Absolutely huge.
Huge, even for a guard player. My sentinel squadron of three came off the flank, started messing around, started messing up your objective holding thing.
Yep.
I had stormtroopers deep striking, and the reason deep striking is safer is that if your deep striker, you put the deep striking mechanic is essentially the same. You put one model down, you roll scatter, wherever he lands, you put your little guys in sort of a spiraling circle out. But if he lands, you know, in the old deep striking rules, and in the new ones too, if you land within an inch of the enemy model, or if that single model lands on an enemy unit, or a friendly can't be placed, or goes off the table, or goes unimpassable, in the old rules, he was dead, right? In the new rules, there's a little table you roll on. And the table's a little better. I think you got a 4+ chance of being okay, right? You just come down later.
Nope.
Not that good?
Can I correct you?
Oh, sure, go ahead. I could be wrong.
Deep strike is actually, it's safer from the aspect of you're probably less likely to lose maybe, I can't say it's safer in any way, really.
Really?
Because before, if you landed your models, you have to, circle them around the model that you land.
Yeah.
And any models that come within 1 inch of the enemy, you lose those models. Those models are dead.
Yeah.
But the rest of the models are fine. Now, the way it works is if any model comes within 1 inch of an enemy, you basically don't get to deploy the whole unit. And instead, you roll on a table.
Well, that's not what I read.
What's that?
That's not how I read it. Yak, I have to read
that again. Trust me. I looked over this several times.
Okay.
Yep, absolutely. Check on it.
I will.
Anyway, so just trust me on this one.
All right.
So if any model would land on within 1 inch of an enemy unit or on a friendly model, for example, basically where you were unable to deploy, impassable terrain, friendly model, or with 1 inch of an enemy, you roll on a table instead. On a 1 or 2, the entire unit is destroyed. On a 3 or 4, the opponent gets to choose where the unit lands anywhere on the table without scatter, and on a 5 or 6, it goes back into reserves, and you do it next turn.
Right.
So, I think it's that not safer. It's actually a little more random.
Yeah, that's not how I interpreted it. So I have to read that again. But if that's correct, you're right. That is definitely more dangerous.
Yep. But I would say with the units coming on from the edges, your scouts, your infiltrators, and deep strike, being in play in every mission, and you're able to put everything in reserves. I think that, and with the running, you're okay with coming in from reserves a little bit more.
Yeah.
That overall, you're able to sort of open the whole board up.
Yeah.
Now, they also cleared up for you, for your FAQ there, John, is they totally clarified what you do in pre-deployment with attaching guys to units and putting them in vehicles, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's completely clear now, which was, it was pretty clear from the leaked PDF that we got earlier. That's the direction they were heading, and you could just see in the codex is the fact that, Dark Angels have no way to get their characters inside of a drop pod based on the 4th edition rules, and anyone with half a brain can figure out, I'm sure Games Workshop wants characters landing in their drop pods with their command squad. So, now it's very, very clear. You can hold anything out in reserve, and then you can attach it to a vehicle, and you can make a single roll for that whole vehicle. So I can take my squad, I can take my character, I can attach the character to the squad, and I can put that whole thing into a vehicle, and I can make one reserve roll for that whole thing to see if it comes on. So
that saved me about 200 points on my up-and-coming Space Wolf army, by the way.
And probably the biggest change to how missions work is how deployment works. Well, it was the biggest change, but certainly a large change in my opinion. And it works like a war machine. So how basically it works is you each roll a D6, and the winner gets to choose to pick his side, pick the deployment zone. He gets to choose, and if he does that, so he gets to be player one. If he's player one, he picks his deployment zone. He puts his entire army down first before the other player deploys anything. Except for infiltrators and deep strikers and all the special stuff. And he is probably going to have turn one. Let's just say for a minute he has turn one. There's one little caveat. Player two doesn't get to pick his deployment zone, but he gets the advantage of seeing your entire deployment before he deploys anything. Then he deploys his entire army with the knowledge that he's probably going to be going second. And the reason I say probably is that unlike War Machine, there is an option for player two to steal turn one. And all that happens is player two says, I'm going to steal turn one, it rolls a D6, and on a 6, he gets turn one instead. Now, I like the first part of all that. I like the War Machine-esque of it, because if I know I'm not going to have turn one, I can deploy more strategically and not get hammered in turn one kind of thing. I really don't understand the steal turn one option much.
Well, I think partly it's because GW wants to make it its own.
Right.
And partly because I liked that element of it, actually, in our games yesterday, because especially in with Khorne Berserkers versus Guard, I felt you deployed first and we're going to get first turn. I felt like at least that die roll gave me one slim hope that I was going to be able to seize the initiative, which is what the rule is called also, right. By the way. Seize the initiative from you and kind of get you off on the knock you back on your heels. Otherwise, I'm not so sure I like the first half of this rule still. I think it works great with War Machine, where your average range is 12 inches. In this game, where everything's looking at 48 or, well, not everything, but your heavy weapons are looking at 48 or 72 and you can't hide behind area terrain and blah, blah, blah. I really did feel like it was a huge disadvantage to me as an assault army. And there's adjustments, and I'm sure tactics will develop for this. And I mean, I think you'll lose a couple of your assault players. They just won't want to deal with it. Most people will just deal with it as we go.
See, I don't see how it changes the rules, though, because here's the thing. You have two choices. You can deploy for turn one and then randomly not get it. Or you can at least know you're probably not going to have turn one and deploy to adjust for it.
Right, but deploying to adjust for it, I think, is misleading when you're saying when there really is nowhere for you to hide. And
well,
yes,
that could be a problem with the terrain that you have. You know, and I think that that's a big adjustment that people are going to have to make.
Right.
You know, I think that Games Workshop is going for the cinematic feel of the true line of sight of terrain, and I'm a big fan of that. But I think that a lot of people's terrain collections don't represent that ideal,
that's true.
So I think that either people will start creating a terrain that blocks line of sight, or you know, people might come up with house rules and just say this piece of area terrain does block line of sight.
Right.
Just to sort of spice up the game. But I do think that you should have, you know, a few key chunks of the board that are inaccessible from the start of the game, or else you are correct that whoever goes second is at a huge disadvantage.
Well, except that I think the cover rule kind of balances it out.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, but
in both those games, you're playing assault armies. Now, the first game you went first, and the second game you went second.
Right.
But still...
Well, no. I'm not saying it's completely unbalanced, but I do feel like you're at a severe disadvantage as an assault army when you don't get that first turn. And in the alternative, in the old system, I mean, it was a 50-50 shot.
Yeah.
You know, and you deployed with some balls if you were going to put everything out there. I think the interplay of all the new rules makes it slightly disadvantageous for an assault army who's going second. It's not... I think it's clear-cut in War Machine that, yeah, it's great, it works fine, because the ranges aren't that great and you can hide stuff. In this game, where the ranges are vastly longer and it's much more difficult, like John said, I mean, people will start developing terrain so that you've got some more areas that you can deal with. But I think that the system... it works differently in 40K, and it's not, I think it's more of a disadvantage in 40K than it would be in War Machine, I guess is all I'm saying.
I think it also encourages players to have armies with diverse styles of deployment and tactics. So,
great point.
Instead of putting all your units in the rhinos, an assault army, and driving forward, or all your units on foot and running forward, that's going to really make you suffer by this first turn assault. Instead, if you take an army that has some deep striking elements or some scouting units that can come on from the edge, now all of a sudden you can keep those units in reserve and the enemy can't fire at you on the first turn. So, so by diversifying your army, you actually decrease the amount of damage you suffer from the first turn.
That's a good point.
That's an excellent point. I hadn't thought about
that.
Very
good point.
And it furthers this theme that the armies are more diversified now, I think.
I agree.
That's a great point.
The special rules definitely are far superior. I definitely want to reread my Deep Strike now, though, because I'm disappointed if it's not as cool as I thought it was.
You got to trust me.
I'm just bummed. I'm depressed now. I'm just a little bummed. But anyway.
Right.
His round little
my
little
happy
face
little,
is frowning.
I'm frowning now. So, and one last thing, and I guess this goes to the style of play, but what I really liked, you know, the majority of missions from the old rule book were basically controlling area, right? And the objective was, in cleanse, for example, get as many units as possible, essentially, many scoring units as possible, which was a lot of different things in your army. Flood the quadrants, or in recon, get across the table, right? Well, in this one, because it's one objective and a single unit can contest, it made for some... The game, in our first game, you decimated me. I mean, you tabled me, basically, to use the vernacular, right? But I had this one I had these two slivers of hope near the end that I had a deep striking stormtroopers came down and they just were messing with the Marines. And if I'd chosen to fire a little differently, I might have won that game, even though my armor's getting decimated. And it
felt, it would have been a tie, probably.
A tie, or at least I would have pulled it out.
Yep.
And in the second game, again, I you pulled out a tie, and I thought I was doing pretty good against you.
Right.
So I think, and then I also made a tie by tank shock through unit and getting it at the last minute. So, like, there was some really, it felt like, I felt less that I was, things were going poorly from luck and more because, well, I have always had a chance, again, because of that diverse army.
Yep.
I have played an army that I, in 4th edition, the Guard Army probably much weaker than it was today because of some of those other units.
No, that's absolutely true.
So, again, I think the objectives make, again, those units like Deep Strikers and Reserves, you know, Scouts, a little more viable.
And it's going to be cool because I'm gonna be making a lot more little objective counters.
That's true.
I mean, because, I mean, my Corn Army comes with three that I made for it special, but having that one little red dot on there kind of detracted somewhat from all the beautiful cauldrons of blood.
We credited, you know, I think GW did look at some of the competitors out there and got some good ideas for the game, and I think it was good they did. And we credited War Machine for maybe inspiring the deployment system. I think we should credit Flames of War
for the objective system. Especially that one in your deployment zone.
Yeah, Flames of War is very similar to that. Everybody makes their own little objective counters, and it's a cool. It was very fluffy. Yeah. I like that part of Flames of War, so that's good.
Yeah.
So let's get to how it plays overall and some of our final thoughts. So what do we think about it, and how do we like it? Who wants to start?
John, why don't you start?
Okay, I'll start. Well, from someone who likes to deal with the minutiae of rules, like myself, I think it's a great step forward in terms of clarity. It's definitely going in the right direction, so I like that progression as the game goes over, you know, years and years and years of getting a little better and better and better, in my opinion. And this is certainly a step along that. And I like the, you know, the fundamentals that they're going with, introducing, you know, unit rules, and I like the missions, and I like, you know, I would say I like about, you know, 80-85% of what I see. It's gotten me excited. You know, I'm excited to try some games out. I'm very excited. That's the best way I can put it. And really what it comes down to me for whether this edition is a huge success or only a mild progression is how they handle the FAQs. Yeah. Because in my opinion, the 4th edition, they really dropped the ball with their the FAQs in terms of not answering questions, but when it comes to you're taking an existing set of codexes and you are saying, here's how you need to play it with this game. In my opinion, you can write a great rule book like they have in this case, but unless they take the same amount of effort into clarifying how each individual codex, the old rules and the old wording works in that new edition, then you're right back at square one. You're right back of you know, ruled arguments and problems and issues. And so I really hope that they take the same time and effort they did to you know, being very careful with the wording of the rulebook, and they apply that to their fifth edition FAQs, which they have said that they have been working on. You know, Phil Kelly said that at Adepticon, they have their fifth edition FAQs ready to be released along with the rulebook.
Oh, wow.
So hopefully those are you know, well written and good to go. And in my opinion, I think you cannot get it right on the first go when it comes to FAQs. In this kind of FAQ where you're converting books, I think you have to put the first ones out there, then you have to see how it goes, and you have to update it. And if they don't do that, then I really think that it will change it from a fantastic success of a new edition to, you know, just another, you know, mild evolution. Uh-huh. So it's really on the fence now.
Now,
we have to see how they handle it, basically.
Now, do you feel there seems to be movement in Games Workshop right now to be more responsive, and they seem to be putting out with fair consistency FAQs for, I know, they're fantasy army books. Do you feel like there may be an impetus in the company now that they understand that this is something that they've dropped the ball on in the past?
Well, you know, it would all be pure speculation on my part, because, you know, a lot of people know that, you know, they've just released about four 40K FAQs for some of the more recent codexes, and they credited myself and the Adepticon Council.
Cool.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
Which was nice, but, in case anyone's wondering, they didn't contact me at all. They just...
Read our FAQ and liked it, apparently. So, you know, I'm flattered, and I would love to help them in any way that I can. You know, if they were to contact me, I would be more than happy to give them whatever feedback that they would like to get from me. But the fact is...
I will say this. Somebody at Glen Burnie does download our podcast each episode. So somebody's listening out there. And if they are, they should definitely look to you for a guy who can help them out.
Right, and you know, I'm not better than anyone else. It's just, you know, it's just something that interests me, and any kind of feedback that I can, you know, the fact that they credited me means that hopefully something we did had some sort of positive impact, and that's all you can really hope for.
Absolutely.
And and you know, from what I heard from Phil at Adepticon again, you know, Alessio, the same guy who wrote the main rules, is also the guy who's in charge of the FAQs now.
Oh, good,
nice.
So you would hope that you know. He seemed to bring a level of attention that was better than before to the rule book. You would hope that same level of attention is in the FAQs. And from these last FAQs that were released, they are better than I would say before. You know, they have a clear errata section, and then they have a list of questions, you know, many of which that are similar to the questions that we had in our FAQ. So, you know, I would say, if they continue down that path, and hopefully they attack the full 5th edition, you know, codex conversions the same way, and I think that it will be good, but we won't really know until we see it.
Yeah.
Good point.
All right, well, it was great stuff. Craig, what did you think about it?
I liked it a lot. I liked just about everything that we encountered. It was very easy to clarify rules as we went, because neither of us really know the rule book down cold yet. I think the jury's still out for me on the deployment and the way that works, coupled with the area terrain not blocking line of sight. But
you
I think
you beat me with an assault army.
No, I beat you with a mixed army, actually. You kicked my butt with the assault army, pretty much. But because of the new system, the objective system, it was a tie, which I like. So see, I think it will require some adjustment, and I think there's going to be a lot of grumbling on that score in particular. But I think I concur with John. If they can support this, I think they've got a win on their hands, a big win. And you, Russ?
Cool. Well. You may have noticed a small background theme to the show, that it was the sign of the end time. The reason for that is that I have been very critical of GW in the past in the show and online, and I have to say that given the parameters of what they were to work with, they have to keep the codexes the same and those kinds of things. I'm not really sure they could have done a better job. This, I think, is an excellent piece of work.
You heard it here first.
Really? I mean, no, seriously. The way it plays. I mean, I'm with you, John. Of course, if they can't back this up with the same sort of style for their codexes, but from everything I've seen, if you look at the new Orc Codex, the new Chaos Codexes were written with this in mind. I think they're heading in the right direction. The game plays faster. It felt. We played two games.
Oh yeah.
We played two 1500 point games inside 4 hours, and that was first time ever playing 5th edition and looking up the rules constantly.
Yep.
We never ran into a rules thing we couldn't quickly and easily figure out. It resolves every one of my gripes that I've claimed in the past about the game. The assault system is totally fixed, in my opinion. The shooting system is much better with the way damage allocation works. I think you got to keep in mind, I know the open terrain thing really was weird and it bothered me too when I took it out of context, but the fact that shooting is only half as effective because basically everybody's got a cover save most of the time really means that, yeah, I'm shooting more at you, but you're going to soak most of it. And that's a big deal. And it's a huge deal for the guard, because when you're lucky to get a wound with the last gun anyway, and then the guy gets his cover save on an orc or whatever, it's really going to make a difference. And I think that's a huge thing. Even your battle cannons, you get to hit a marine squad, they make their cover saves. So it's a real interesting battle. It's much more cinematic. The army still felt right.
Yep.
The chaos army and the salt marine army, those bikes came in there. It felt right. I was still scared my pants off as a guard player. Oh, here they come. The guards still shot. They still were just as effective as always, which basically means took the whole army to kill 5 bikes. But it was cool. It still felt like 40K. All the cinema, all the fluff still worked. And yet the games felt smoother and faster.
I would argue that the fluff works better now.
I would think so, too.
I mean, the guard don't feel like, and you touched me, and my game is over.
And you know what else I like about the area terrain thing? You can put more terrain on the table to force maneuver, but you can still see stuff and shoot it, because when you get to the point where, like, an all-wooded table, it's just such a huge advantage for a lot of the assault armies, especially the tier into ones that had fleet and you didn't move it, you didn't have it before. Yeah. Now at least you got a chance. You know, now at least you can pepper them and have a chance. So I really think I think it's much, much stronger. I'm really impressed. It's a lot of fun to play. I'm not gonna put down my War Machine and flip back over to 40K. I just like War Machine for the competitive nature of it. But I'm definitely looking forward to some of the new guard rumors I'm seeing. You know, I'm the new guard bikes and some of the rumors about the guard skimmers coming out and stuff. Hey, man, I'm going to keep my guard army primed and ready to go. I'm going to watch for those new models and pick up the new guard codex for sure. I'm getting the new 40K book. I think it's a solid game. And if you're looking for a army scale sci-fi game, I think GW is
the king is back, baby.
Yeah, I really do. I think they've got a strong rule set here. I mean, they could still, woo-hoo, there's plenty of ways to screw it up, but I think they're on the right path right now. I have to agree with John. And I know it's funny too, because we're all sort of, you know, John was even cautiously optimistic. He's a fan. He's but they're still, and you know, if you look on the website, all the rumors about the guard, for example, people are typing in like, I don't believe this because this is too much like my dream list. You know, I don't believe any of these rumors because this is exactly what I want to have happen.
Yeah.
You know, so it's, I think they really are listening to their fans and reacting to it. And I think they're, and that's awesome. I think it's exciting.
Great if this could be an indication of things to come.
And what a crazy summer. All these great games coming out. I don't even want to duel myself.
I know.
Freaking games. So, Rafe, what are your thoughts?
All right.
This craziness.
Russ has so pooped me out, Craig, that now I can't give him the flack that he deserves after this marathon podcast. And hey, John, thanks a lot for hanging in there.
Yeah, we're sorry to keep you so late.
It's all right.
All right, so to wrap it up, what do I think? So Craig will back me up on this. I was listening and have been an avid listener of Jeff's Podhammer podcast, and it really got my brain itching to play an army-scale game, and I decided I'm playing Warhammer Fantasy Battles.
Oops.
And I was, like, petrified to tell Russ, right, Craig? Because I'm going to go, What are you doing? I can't believe it.
In fact, I can remember a couple conversations where I don't think I want to tell Russ yet.
Right. Because I just knew the flack I would get from Wakeland. So I was, you know, secretly building, and I'm building a Vampire Count's army. We'll get to that in another section. And I was enjoying
the lore.
Yes, I was enjoying the lore of it, and it was really cool. Well, literally, on the day that Craig and I are playtesting and fooling around with Warhammer Fantasy Battle, Russ comes streaming up from Game Castle like a comet out of Hades. I can't believe it. I read the book. It's unbelievable. And he's just going like, you know, a mile a minute. Yeah. So it just was funny how words he flip-flopped.
I don't believe it. Those guys fixed everything. It was exactly every problem I had with the game.
Actually, the first words, because I was the one on the phone with you, your first words were, I don't know how to say this, Craig. Will you play 40K with me?
Actually, I didn't know he said that.
That's exactly what he said.
So, Craig, kudos to you for hanging in there with him this long.
Oh, I see.
And you've got your 40K player. Now, me, I sold all my 40K, and I wished I didn't. simply just so I could...
try it, at least.
You know, just so I could, you know, play a game, because I do like army-scale games. Am I going to switch away from fantasy? No, because Russ Jedi mind tricked me 8 years ago. I wanted to play fantasy, and somehow I got wrapped up in his, I'm a treadhead, and I love sci-fi, and I'm like, me too, and, you know. So I wish I had it, my Nurgle, just to play it. Am I going to start a brand-new army? No. If Craig loaned me an army and said, play a game with me, would I? Yes. Am I going to play it competitively? No. I still like Warhammer. I still like Hordes. But when I want to play an army game, I'm going to look to the GW game because I think they make a good game. And I'm excited to hear that the 5th edition 40K sounds as tight as a fantasy game would be from what I'm learning from scratch and listening to Podhammer.
So now we got to rate it on the new. Now, the new. John, do you understand our complicated...
Really? Do you have to ask me that? Yeah, I got it.
Okay.
Well, right. We do have to ask you, because so Rafe keeps forgetting about it.
We're going to write an FAQ for Rafe, basically.
I don't get it.
Yeah, if you could whip up an FAQ on this, John, we'd be appreciative.
So, Rafe, now that you play fantasy, okay, here's what I'm going to give you an analogy. Now that you play fantasy.
We will translate it into the D6G system.
The D6G system is you want to rate a game on how good, how likely it is that a person will enjoy it on the roll of a D6. So the lower is better, like an armor save. So a good armor save would be 2+, right? So
correct.
If we rated this game 2+, that would mean that every player that rolled a D6, If they roll a 2 plus or better, they're going to enjoy it, so they really like it. A bad rating would be 6 plus, because that would mean it's probably not going to like the game.
The way to think of it, Rafe, is to rate it on a 5-star system and then subtract that number from 6.
Oh, that's way too
okay.
Yeah.
And with 40K...
No, actually, he just translated it for me.
Oh,
okay,
did
so
that work?
5? Yeah, 5-star system.
How many stars?
Okay, got it.
Okay.
And then subtract it from a D6, okay.
Yeah.
And then add plus to the end.
Yeah. Oh, now you're going to confuse them.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
So let's start with John. What did you say, John?
Okay. Well, as I said before, I think it's going to ultimately depend on how the integration of the codex has come. So this is a provisional rating, and it'll move up or down depending on the FAQ support of the codexes.
Yep.
So for now, I'm going to say very, very pleased, so a 3+, and it could slide up or down depending on which way those FAQs go.
Are you going to twin link that 3+, or go 3+ straight up?
It's going to be a 3+, and then if the FAQs are great, it's going to be a twin linked, and if its FAQs aren't so great, it's going to slide down to a 4.
Okay. All right, okay. Craig, what do you think?
I'm going to give it a... I think I might give... I don't know. Well, I'm wavering between a 3+ and a 3+ twin linked, but I'm going to give it a 3+ for right now. I am, mainly because of that deployment thing.
I'm going to cheat, and I'm going to give it 2 ratings.
Oh. Okay,
I think for the someone who's been away from 40K for a long time, or someone who's never played 40K before but is a war gamer coming to it, I'm going to give it a 3+ twin linked.
Oh,
but
wow,
but. Assuming that does assume that the codexes follow along well with the book, but if you're a veteran 40K player, I'm going to rate it worse, because I think the veteran, I don't think as many veterans are as open-minded, perhaps, John, as you are.
And no,
I think they're going to come in with the baggage. They're going to come in with a lot of things they don't like, and I'm going to say it's going to might even be as bad as 4+, or maybe even 5+, until they play a few games and just suck it up.
Wow.
Because, seriously, this guy's that won't even play it right now. But it always happens, right? Yeah, I'm not going to 5th. But
I can remember the
but
whole
But the area terrain thing is really going to be a problem if people get by. And a lot of people will be like I was initially and hear about that and hate that so much they won't even read the book. And until you read the book and really think it through and try to put it all together in your head, I'm worried about that. But I think if you go with an open mind and look at it as like a whole new war game to try to learn and experience and enjoy as a total, I think it's a solid system. I can only go. I really do.
Well, there you go.
That's it. And thanks, right. John.
Hey, what am I? I know I'm a garbage and transvestite.
I believe the technical term is chopped liver.
All right, Hollywood, give us a rating.
All right, I'm going to man up here, and I'm just going to give it 1 rating. I'm going to give it a 5+. Now, I haven't played the game
or read the book.
but I'm concerned about John's points about the codexes. I'm very concerned about that, how they change the rules midway through, and that's why I'm going to give it that rating.
All right, there you go.
Well, fair enough.
John, thank you very, very much for putting up with us for this long period of time.
All right,
thank your boss for us too.
Hopefully, I haven't been fired while I'm sitting here.
Hopefully, you have a job to go back to.
Yes. But listen, explain to them it's Hollywood of the D6G. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Oh, I will. I will.
Yeah. Don't mention garbage or transvestites, though.
Well, they know all about that, too. You know, right outside the door.
Tell them it's New York City from the D6G, then.
Oh, there you go.
Like, you just open the window here and garbage and transvestites pour
come
in.
Come in.
Like a tidal wave.
Not that there's anything wrong with that. Any transvestites listening, this is purely family humor.
John. Thanks so much again for not only being on the show, but all the work you do for the gaming community and Dakka Dakka. And thanks again for being on the show, and we look
great
forward to seeing you
everything.
Online.
It was a pleasure, and anytime you want me back, I would be glad to come back.
Sure, we'll
all right.
Glad
out,
to have
sure.
you.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye.
Do you ever notice that every time you go to any sort of gaming event, there's always going to be some guy who thinks, just because you're there pushing little toy soldiers around railroad terrain, and maybe you happen to be wearing a black t-shirt, that you give a good goddamn what he has to say about anything. Now, before I go on, I want to clarify. I'm going to come across as the grumpy gamer here. Which I am. That's my role here on the D6 Generation. Do you ever notice I'm always grumpy? So if I come across as grumpy here, well, put a little star on your forehead for observational skill and sit back and relax, because I haven't even hit my stride yet. So this guy comes up, and invariably he's got a project he's been working on. It might be a real assault cannon. It might be a life-size Jack model. It might be a dastardly plot between him and a small mouse in his pocket to take over the world. But whatever it is, he just knows you want to know about it. So there you are. You're playing a game, innocent and fancy-free. That's how you roll. And suddenly, someone is so deep into your personal space you feel you might just have to give a brief lecture on physics and the inability of two objects to occupy the same space at the same time. He's standing closer than your wife, your girlfriend, or your codependent dog. He's invariably a close talker, too, and he wants to talk to you. Here in New Hampshire, we call these fictional characters hammerheads, after a character in the Dilbert cartoon. When the hammerhead approaches you, there's very little, if any, preamble. He will generally just jump into the middle of his big scheme. I think it would be great if Space Marines were fish. I've been knocking together a codex at home. Or, don't you think the casters you have to choose from in your faction are limited? I've been making up my own. My sister says they're totally balanced. What are you supposed to do now? You can smell whatever the guy had for lunch probably better than he can remember it himself. If you don't back up soon, you're going to be in danger of a future paternity suit. And yet, here's this person, clueless as to the utter and complete disinterest that is coursing through every vein of your body. And he won't go away. Now, don't get me wrong. Hammerheads aren't bad people. I find myself saying this a lot. None of these archetypes are bad people. Except maybe the uber power gamer. But anyway, they're not bad people. They're probably very nice, and all they want is to share their passion with you. But seriously, where in the gamer's handbook does it say that you have to be interested in every off-the-reservation-themed army rules variant house rule and modeling conversion plan that springs from the fever dreams of every half-baked socially... They're really not bad people. They're really not bad people. In the end, there's not much you can do. Either you take up the flag of grumpy gamers everywhere and you tell them you're not interested, or you smile and nod till your head falls off. Or you try to ignore them. In the end, unless you've got your neck all greased up for some serious nodding and you've treated your teeth like some supermodel for hours of smiling, you're going to come across as the jerk. Which is okay, because if you're anything like me, you probably are the jerk. But you know what? After a few cold shoulders, you've got a reputation. And soon, you won't have to deal with hammerheads anymore. Of course, no one else will want to talk to you either, but hey, more gaming time for you, right? Or maybe it would be better to listen, smile, and nod. Who knows? You might learn something you didn't know before. Maybe someday some college dropout working in a grocery store really will make a bolter that works. And on that day... You don't want to be the grumpy gamer who gave him the cold shoulder now, do you? Good night.
Achievement unlocked! You've made it to the end of another D6 Generation episode, the podcast whose humor has universally been acclaimed as not too horrible. Please let us know what you thought of the show by either emailing us at info@thed6generation.com or by posting in our official D6G episode thread at the top of the Dakka Discussions Forum on DakkaDakka.com. If for some inexplicable reason you actually enjoyed this show, you can help others find out about it by leaving positive reviews on iTunes. See you in 2 weeks. Thanks for listening, and happy gaming.